This is an important announcement for anyone thinking about advertising here on Everyone Loves Guitar. We've experienced incredible growth. We currently have over 82,000 monthly listens, and I would anticipate cracking six figures in the next few months. We've also grown our YouTube subscriber base by 72 times. During this time, we've kept our advertising rates consistent, but I wanted to let you know we'll be increasing these rates after the first of the new year. So if you're a business looking to generate new leads or increase your cash flow by adding new clients or customers, or if you're looking for general brand exposure, or if you're a label looking to promote new music and you want to lock into the current advertising rates before they go up at the end of this year, then listen closely. Fill in the short form at everyonelovesguitar.com/advertise. That's everyonelovesguitar.com/advertise. Even if you want to advertise next year, contact us now and you'll get to lock into the current rates before they go up at the end of this year. Thanks for listening. See you soon.
If you want to buy or sell a home or investment property and you're here in the Tampa Bay area, in Hillsborough, Pinellas, or Pasco counties, then listen up. West Florida Real Estate is a local residential real estate broker that's helped over 250 Bay Area homeowners buy and sell their properties in the last 4 years alone. If you're looking to sell, you'll want to get their free report, The 7 Biggest Mistakes Homeowners Make When Hiring a Realtor. And if you're looking to buy a property, you definitely want to get your hands on The 21 Most Expensive Mistakes Tampa Home Buyers Make When Buying a Home. Each one of these reports is going to save you time and money. Inside, you'll discover the 7 most important things to consider when hiring a realtor, what to do if you're buying and selling a home at the same time, and the danger of choosing a realtor who agrees with everything you say. To get your hands on these free reports, head on over to westfloridarealestate.com. That's westfloridarealestate.com.
Hey, this is Craig. If you like this show and you want to support it and you want to keep it free, head on over to everyonelovesguitar.com/support. That's everyonelovesguitar.com/support. Hey, everybody. This is Craig Garber. Welcome to Everyone Loves Guitar. I got a really cool guest, very successful young guitar player here, man. And he has the finest hats you will ever see, as a matter of fact. With Joshua Ray Gooch, a few announcements before we get going. I want to give a shout out to It Takes a Nation, Adam Miller, Corey Cherko, and Yogi Lanich for connecting us, because all three of those guys had recommended you. Also remind you to go to everyonelovesguitar.com/subscribe, where you can subscribe to the show on podcasts and on a YouTube channel. And while you're there, enter your name in the little box at the top so we can get on our newsletter list so we can connect. All righty, let's rock on. Joshua Ray Gooch, guitarist, songwriter, producer, educator. Born in Seattle, started playing guitar at 13. He's got a good story. After 3 years of playing, and he's self-taught, he was contacted by industry legend Johnny Sandlin after hearing Joshua's self-recorded demo CD. Sandlin, of course, produced the Allman Brothers, Widespread Panic, Delbert McClinton, and many more. Joshua went on to become Johnny's house session guitarist, and he played on sessions with Bonnie Bramlett, Jimmy Hall, Chuck Lavelle, and loads of other people. In 2009, were you like 11? What the hell?
I think I was 16 or something.
How the hell did you compete? Joshua was a national finalist in Guitar Center's King of the Blues competition. That evening, he met Robert M. Knight, a legendary rock photographer and manager who began managing Joshua. Not long after that, their professional relationship had started. Joshua got his first touring gig with Bee's singer, Koshi Inaba. We'll talk about this for sure, man, because I got to believe that was pretty amazing. And I've had Shane Gallis on the show. He played with Bee's. But if you don't know about Bee's, they're the highest selling Japanese band in history. They've sold more than 90 million albums. Wow. And yeah. When you sell a record, for those of you who are baby boomers, that's like, used to be you could sell records. Yes. As a result of this exposure, Joshua in 2011 toured Japan and Thailand, headlining sold out solo clinic in most major cities. In 2013, he toured Europe with Grammy nominated artist Beth Hart, filling in for Joe Bonamassa. That same year, he also became the lead guitarist for Shania Twain. He spent the next 2 years playing with Shania during her residency at the Coliseum at Caesar's Palace, which he's about to go do again. And he also continued touring with her on her Rock This Country tour. He's also worked with a variety of TV shows. He was in the house band for both America's Got Talent and Glee, as well as performing stunt as a stunt guitarist songwriter and session guitarist on CSI, Crime Scene Investigation. I'm going to talk about all this with you. I want to finish this up, but that you've done all this at such a young age means way beyond that you're a great player. You really got to have your like personality shit together. And that's really a big thing at a guy your age. And I'm saying in a positive way, I'm not like minimizing your age like you're a younger guy. In 2015, Joshua was approached by Hal Leonard to write an instruction book and DVD on improvisation called Lead Guitar Licks, The Basics and Beyond. And he also writes a monthly column for Premier Guitar Magazine. Dude, thank you so much. I appreciate you coming on the show.
I'm happy to be here, man. It's been so cool to get a chance to do this because, like you said, you've had a ton of my friends on here. And not only friends, I mean, the guys that you mentioned earlier, Yogi and Shane and Corey, are kind of more, they're more than for their mentors. They're kind of everything. So that was really cool to get a recommendation from those guys. Cause those are all three guys that I respect just beyond belief. And I've learned so much from them. And just like how to function in the music business, how to tour. I'm sure we'll get more into that, but those guys are all three of those guys are really special dudes.
Right on, man. Yeah. They all yeah. And they've all been around through the ringer too, highs and lows.
Yes, they have. Yeah.
Man, so you started playing at 13, all right? 3 years later, Johnny Sandlin hears a demo CD you made. So my question is, and this is why I think you're really cool, what prompted you to make a CD, and how did that get in Johnny Sandlin's hands?
Well, so it's even more specific than that. So yeah, I started playing at 13 and was immediately obsessed, and then 3 years in, at the time, and even now thinking about it, it feels like a world apart from 13 to 16. I know that seems strange, but like that was my entire musical journey because I had not played, I had not been in band, I hadn't played another instrument. I had absolutely no musical history before that point. So
really amazing.
It was so immediate, but the demo thing, it wasn't even a demo that I released. I recorded that for Johnny.
Okay, so you said, hey, I know this guy's around here. I want to send him my stuff.
But it's even more weirdly specific than that. My dad came home from work one day, and this is at this point in high school, I was 16. I was absolutely obsessed with the Allman Brothers Band. I was so nerdy about it that I was online sending blank CDs to like Oklahoma and North Dakota to get board tapes from Allman Brothers.
I did that, man.
Yeah. I was like, oh, I want to get this show that has Jimmy Herring and Derek Trucks. And then, oh, there's a show with Warren Haynes and Jack Pearson. So I was like all over it. So they were my whole world. My dad knew that because my dad introduced me to the Allman Brothers Band. So
was your dad in music at all?
My dad plays guitar and sings. He never did it like full on professionally, but he's just a really talented guy. Like if there's a guy that's going to hop up at a Christmas hang with the family and improvise a full song about everybody in the room, and that's my dad.
So what does he do? What kind of work does he do?
He's in sales.
Oh, okay. I was going to say
it's a very social sort of personality. Yeah. Weirdly, he's not always social, but he's kind of like me where when he's out, he's social. When he's not, he's, very much, would rather just sit down alone and read and hang out by himself all day. But he was kind of more in the sort of CSNY thing, as far as like the way that the kind of songs that he writes and vocals and plays some acoustic guitar. It wasn't a lot of electric. He kind of brought that out once I started playing. But he went to work and there was a lady there who was like, she found out I played guitar through somebody at the job and was like, hey, I dated Greg Allman in the 60s.
So did every woman.
That was my dad's joke. I think he said something like, well, who didn't?
Yeah. What makes you special?
Yes, exactly. And then they laughed about it and stuff, but she was like, I don't have Greg's number anymore. We've lost touch over the years, but I do have the contact to this guy, Johnny Sandlin. And I knew who Johnny was. I wouldn't say that I was completely versed in his
Yeah, well, how and why would you be at that point?
I just knew about the Allman Brothers stuff. Yeah. But all the other stuff, his involvement with Capricorn Records and him producing solo records for like the Greg Allman Laid Back album, which I think is one of the best post, you know, or solo Allman Brothers ventures. So I knew a little bit about him, and she gave him the email. I sent him out, or she gave my dad the email. I sent Johnny an email just introducing myself, told him who I was. And he responded. I didn't think he was going to, but he did. And he was like genuinely interested in hearing me play and said, do you have any recordings? So I didn't want to tell him no. So instead of saying no and answering the email right away, I went, because I'd never done any recording. I had no history with recording. I'd never been in the studio ever. I found that a local Boys and Girls Club had a recording studio.
Wow.
This is in San Diego. And
that's where you lived at the time?
Yes. Okay. Yeah. So I actually moved from Seattle to San Diego when I was like 7 or 8.
Okay.
And then I was there pretty much the rest of the time. So I found a local Boys and Girls Club, went to Guitar Center, bought a backing track CD, a couple of them. I so went funny. And literally recorded myself playing front to back on one of the backing track things, just improvising melodies and then trying to make it a song where I'd have like a melody and I improvised the whole thing. And then the guy gave us a CD and then one to send to Johnny. And that was it.
So this is right before digital.
Yes. Yeah. Cause this would have been like 2007. Yeah. 2007, eight, something right around there. I think 2007.
That's amazing.
So I literally took this CD with me jamming to these backing tracks and sent it to Alabama. 2 weeks later, I'm in a Chili's with my mom, and I get this phone call, and I didn't recognize. It was before phone said, like, Alabama or whatever. It just said the number, so I was like, I don't know what this is. So I picked it up, and I could barely hear the guy, and I remember being like, who talks like this? So, I think it was probably the accent and then the volume level. So I couldn't really hear him. So I was like, Mom, I'm going to go outside.
Speak up, you hillbilly.
Yes. So I go outside and I hear Johnny Sandlin. I was like, oh, Johnny, how's it going? And he's so soft-spoken. He's so nice. And he literally goes, hey, I heard your CD you sent out. I really love your playing. I would love for you to fly out this summer and record on some albums at my studio in Alabama.
Holy crap.
Just on the spot. And I said, of course. Yes. I'll figure out a way to make that work. And then he said, do you play slide guitar? I said, yes. I did not.
Of course. Yeah. Yeah.
I owned one and I had like dinked around on it for a day and then been like, this sounds terrible. And then put it away, which I think everybody has false starts with slide because the barrier to entry is pretty steep, at least at first. It's like sort of a cat getting run over by a big rig for like, you know, at least a couple of weeks, even if you're putting in time, and then you start to figure it out. So I basically, it was 2 months from then that I was going to go out and record them. So I played slide only for 2 months, like 8 hours a day. And the slide guitar I played on some of the albums made the records.
Wow. Where in Alabama is he located?
He was located in Decatur, Alabama. Which is even a small town for people that live in Alabama.
Did you happen to meet, any chance, Ricky Hirsch?
I don't think so. Okay. And my world was pretty small. It was kind of like, because this was sort of this was pre-social media and pretty much, right? There was MySpace, but I don't even think I had Facebook really was on my radar yet. So I didn't really have any contacts from like people seeing that I was there and hitting me up, which happens a lot now. It was kind of just the world with which I was given, right? So it was Johnny and then whoever Johnny knew. I was recording the album he brought me out there to play on was this album from this band called Highly Kind. This guy named Albert Simpson wrote the music, but like the drummer on the record was Dwayne Trucks, Derek Trucks' younger brother, who's now in Widespread Panic. And the bass player was this guy, Kevin Scott, who's like a total legend in Atlanta. He's a young guy because he actually showed me Wayne Krantz's music and now he plays with Wayne Krantz. Like,
does he really? I had Wayne on this show. He's a pretty interesting cat.
Yeah. And he's amazing. So when I was that age, like Kevin, I remember him showing me Wayne Krantz live at the 55 bar with Keith Carlock and Tim LaFave.
Right.
And then 8-9 years later, he is, because Tim LaFave moved out to LA. I know him out here. But Kevin's now in that spot playing with Wayne on tours. Cool, so it was, it's a crazy small world. But yeah, I was thrown into this sort of lion's den with some real heavy cats, because I'd really not played with anybody other than very brief punk rock bands from when I first started, and then playing in blues clubs. That was it. That was the entirety of my live musical experience. I'd never been in the studio other than that one time I recorded that Boys and Girls Club guitar thing. That was really it. So it was an entirely new experience for me. My mom flew out there with me. She was a trooper, man. She was like, you know, staying up late, going to shows. I was playing in like Tuscaloosa and then driving back. It was because I was playing with these guys as well. So my mom, trooper, because my mom's an aerobic instructor, personal trainer. She wakes up at like 4:30 in the morning.
Oh,
so
wow.
Her schedule is very different than especially mine at that age.
Than a musician, yeah.
So she was a trooper, man. She was like, let's do this. Like, she's game. When she decides to do something, she's game. So she was out at these crazy bars with, you know, I mean, we're in some real, like, real Alabama shit. This
wasn't bars, like, yeah.
Dive bars in Tuscaloosa, dive bars like the Florabama, like all sorts of crazy, crazy stuff. My mom doesn't drink at all. She never, ever has. I don't either. So it was kind of like we're in these crazy, you know, bar situations and stuff. And, you know, you make it work. You just
must have felt great though, playing, getting that experience. And like, you really got, not to take away from the work you put in between 13 and 16, but you got a shortcut in a sense.
Totally. It was the weirdest thing because I didn't come from a music business family at all. Like,
yeah.
there was no, this, the lady at my dad's work was such a random connection. I never even met her. I still have never met her.
You still haven't met her. That's funny.
No, because he hasn't worked there in years now, but it was so random. And yeah, coming from a non-music business family, I mean, people maybe in the rest of the country think, oh, San Diego's close to LA. You might as well be. I might as well have been living in Seattle. There was no difference. I don't think I'd even been to LA. You don't travel. Why would you travel to the same climate? Why would you drive 3 hours?
Unless you have you wouldn't.
It makes no sense. So it was really like there. I was in like the suburbs of San Diego. There was no. San Diego is fairly depleted as far as music anyway.
Right.
So there just wasn't a lot around. Nobody played music at my high school really in a serious way. And if they did, they especially weren't playing the style of music that I was, or the styles I was interested in.
Sure.
So, yeah.
All right. I have a bunch of questions. First of all, that's a great story. And I'm really happy that worked out like that. I mean, that was like the best thing happened at every decision-making point, sort of, you know?
Yeah. And when I'm sure we'll get into it, but there's more to that story. Because, you know, I ended up graduating. He asked me to graduate high school early and move. No, I think he said, when you graduate high school, do you want to come out and work full time as my studio guitarist? So, cause I went out there
for the summer,
for the summer in between junior and senior year.
Okay.
And the way my high school worked, I could graduate half a year early with the credits I'd acquired from doing like random AP classes. So I graduated high school like 6 months early and moved to Alabama alone.
Wow. And you were what, like 16 then or 17?
I think I'd maybe just turned 17.
Wow.
Yeah. So I moved out there alone. I just turned 17. And then I started working with Johnny. And unfortunately, Johnny had some very serious, which I don't want to get into, but he had some very serious health issues and couldn't record. So then at that point, I was stranded. I was in Alabama. I wasn't going to college. I had no money. I wasn't 21, so I couldn't book any gigs. I didn't know anybody. The only job I moved to literally the middle of nowhere, Alabama, to do was with Johnny. And I'd gotten to play on some recordings and like the Bonnie Bramlett gospel recording. And unfortunately I didn't get to track live too often with these guys, but I got to play on records with guys like Chuck Lavelle and Jimmy Hall and Bonnie Bramlett and, you know, some heavy people. But all of a sudden the work was gone. So it took me, I had to like do a whole bunch of shit to get back to San Diego and leave Alabama after like 9 months of being there.
Can you have just called up your mom and dad and said, hey, can you guys help me out?
Well, it was, I had gotten into a lease. So I had like had a year
so you had
this place. And it was really weird. Like the way that I got out of it was this guy who's like an army veteran saw that the building was, because I wasn't staying at the place, I was kind of traveling and touring, and they were showing off my place to people illegally when I wasn't there. And this guy, this army vet told me, and my mom and I called and were like, look, no hard feelings is if you let us get out of the lease officially. And they let us out.
Oh, that's cool. So everything, that's good how it worked out. That's nice.
It worked out. It could have been a total disaster, but I was there for probably 4 or 5 months too long where it was like, I was truly stranded in the ultimate culture shock, you know. As great as people in Alabama could not have been nicer, but that's a big transition.
Yeah.
You know? So, and then I ended up back in San Diego, and that's when I was sort of pushed into trying the King of the Blues again, because I had done it before. I don't know if this was even really out there. I had done it at 16, and I made it two rounds in to the final of the San Diego one. So I made it to like the final of anywhere in San Diego that had Guitar Center. There was five people left. I was in that final, and I didn't get through. And I thought, man, I thought I was going to get through on that. And the guys came up to me, the judges, because they're just local judges. They like get local older cats to judge. And they said, we think you can come back and win in a couple of years. So at the time, I was pissed. I was like, that's not your choice. Like, you were just asked to locally judge. I was really bummed out and probably being a little baby about it. But I wasn't as sad as much as I was kind of angry. I was just like, it's not that much of a choice. But you know what? To those guys, if they ever see this, they were right. Because when my parents, when I got back from Alabama, my parents were like, you should try this thing out. So I decided to sign up sort of begrudgingly. But I was like, you know what? I could win some free gear, guitars, amps.
Sure.
And who knows what's going to happen. You know, these things are so weird. Music. And I was also, you know, music's not a competition, man. you know, it was like, you know, that typical which it's true, but it's which also
true,
like,
but this
you're
is
17, so
yeah, but
like,
this is a competition. It's not that the music's not, you're in it, you just I get it.
So I joined that, and then literally 4 months later or whatever, it was down from whatever 3,500 people in the country to five. And I was one of the national finalists. It was like, what happened? I didn't even it was because, you know, every like 3 weeks you go to a different Guitar Center and you do this thing again. You do the comp. So I did like four of them.
What do you think was different about your playing from 3 years earlier? That
so much. First of all, I was playing slide. So I played slide a lot in the competition, which really
nobody's doing that. So that's like a niche thing that you have zero comp or close to zero competition.
Yes. And now a lot of people are doing it more because of Derek Trucks and, Blake Mills and a lot of these people that play a lot of slide. So now it's not as uncommon, but I know that sounds weird to say, but like what would that have been?
It's just less uncommon now. It's still uncommon. It's less, there's not two guys doing it. There's like six, which is three times more. So I guess,
exactly. And I think it's also probably the circles that I run in LA, there's a lot of, and Nashville, there's a lot of players. So I mistakenly, it's probably almost everybody that's good at slide.
That's it. The cliff falls off at zero after that. Yeah,
exactly. So there was that. And I just think that I got better. I mean, look, at that point in my life, that's one of the things that I do miss about being younger is like having essentially no responsibilities at all.
No shit.
Right. Yeah. And just being able to practice all fucking day. I mean, that's all I was doing. Like I was just getting home from school and working for 8-9 hours a day and passing out. So the competition thing, I think my playing had gotten a lot better. You know, you continue to get influences, your time gets better, your phrasing gets better. You're sort of, you know, I don't know. I think it was all there. I listen back and I obviously cringe and I'm like, this guy sucks when I hear old videos of myself. But it's funny. It's you see the kernels of your future self in those videos as much as you hate what you're doing. You're like, okay, I can see where that developed from.
That's cool.
Yeah. You can see. So because like maybe once every 2 years, I'll watch that King of the Blues thing or somebody will send it to me and I'll put it on.
Right.
And it's just interesting to watch. Like I obviously would do way better now. At least I would know that, but
yeah.
So I think within those couple of years, and especially that early on, there's a lot of improvement that's made.
Cool, man.
Yeah.
I want to point out a few things, because this show is really more about success and how you got there, and the things you created. You did a bunch of stuff on your own that may not have worked, but it worked in about as optimal way as possible. Like making, like, first of all, having the courage to, I mean, I would imagine you had a really good childhood.
Yes. I was okay. Very, very fortunate that my parents are fantastic people. They're still married. They were together the whole time. I have a younger brother, 2 years younger. So it's just me and my younger brother, who lives like a mile and a half away from me in LA.
That's cool.
We just went on a run last night together. Like,
oh, that's awesome.
Like, I hang out. I see my brother like 4 times a week. We get coffee. That's almost great. Every morning.
That's awesome.
So yeah, we had a great situation. You know, I grew up in Seattle until I was 7 and then moved to San Diego. But you know, I feel like I learned a lot as a kid, as far as like just not bitching and working hard and just being committed once you decide to do something, you know, to truly commit and not to half-ass it.
Well, the reason I said that is because it, you know, 16 or whatever age you sent that tape, that CD to Johnny, that's a rough age in general. And you don't feel confident. You don't feel good about yourself. You don't. And if you have confidence, it's false confidence for the most part. But the fact that you went and did that, not only did it show that you're ambitious, but that you had the confidence to do that and you weren't afraid. And you might have been a little scared, but you did it anyway.
Yeah, you know, I've always been somebody that sort of holds both extremes. And I think this is something that overall comes in handy. There's times it doesn't. But I think I am very, very hard on myself. But I'm also extremely driven and ambitious and know what I want to get done.
Yeah.
In that exact situation, like, I didn't think I was like, dude, I'm the shit. I didn't think that, but I was also like, it was that acknowledgement of like, I'm putting in a lot of time. So I would love to just get, I mean, honestly, I thought maybe the most I would get from Johnny is a little bit of feedback, whether that was encouragement or sort of criticism. I didn't really care. Like, I wanted to get criticism. I wanted that.
Yeah,
because
yeah.
I was criticizing myself so much that, you know, internally I wasn't, you know, just going around, you know, talking shit on myself and sort of self-defeating. But I think that I wanted criticism because I wanted to get better. Like,
yeah,
this was really before I even knew that being in the music industry was an option.
Right.
I mean, I was still planning on going to college. I didn't know. I was kind of like, I like debating people. Maybe I'll be a lawyer.
The world does not need another lawyer, so thank you.
Yes, at the time, I was like, I like arguing. I like debating people.
I like arguing. I'll become a lawyer.
I can get paid
for it.
That was really my logic.
It's very appropriate. I don't see any flaw with that logic, actually.
Especially at that age. I maybe didn't envision all the like BS paperwork that you have to do as a lawyer and all that stuff. And it doesn't sound as glamorous as it looked on TV as a kid.
Right. But still, not bad logic. It's very, you know, very logical, linear thought progress, to be honest.
Yeah, but I didn't realize, you know, I didn't realize, like, my job now even exists at that time. Because, like, I thought, oh, when you go see B.B. King or Eric Clapton or whatever, like, that's their band.
Yeah.
It's like, well, it is, but also they can fire them for no reason with no necessary explanation. And those people can just be let go like that.
Right.
And they can be replaced. And, you know, I just thought, like, oh, that's their band.
You don't know these things. Band. Sure.
So I didn't really realize my current job of, like, playing with an artist and being their, like, right-hand guitar player.
Sure.
Existed. So I just thought, like, oh, you got to get into a band or that's it. You know, Instagram and seeing all these sort of career paths being documented wasn't really a thing.
Absolutely.
So yeah, it was, you know, it's a little bit of trial by fire,
but But I give you all the credit in the world for having the courage to reach out to him and then to make that thing, because, you know, a lot of times people are like, well, I don't know if it'll work. You're 100% right. But if you don't do it, you're guaranteed it won't work.
That's
what my attitude, I always
say. It probably won't work, but you still do it.
Yeah, right. Yeah. I mean, you don't know, you know, but plus the experience of doing it, look, you got to go in the studio. So now you're like, no, I got this studio stuff. It's not as hard as I thought.
Yeah, and then just little things that take some acclimation, like what it's like to record with headphones on.
Right.
All these things seem minor, and I always talk to, like, with my students now, I'm always telling them, like, all this stuff that you don't think, like,
how to work with in-ear monitors. I've talked to a lot of guys, especially, you know, older guys that spent 25 years without them, and all of a sudden they're like, holy shit, I can't, you know.
Dude, I'll get to some of those stories with the Koshianaba stuff, because I had never used in-ear monitors until I was playing in arenas.
Right.
Just the first night was my first show with him, and that was with the first in-ear monitor show. But all the sort of stuff that you can prep with that seem like intangibles and almost inconsequential are actually a huge deal. Like, practicing your show standing up versus sitting down.
Yeah.
Stuff like huge. That. Something like practicing slide standing up. Dude, if you don't think
that is gotta be hard.
The difference between sitting and standing on guitar, on slide guitar especially, is massive because it's fretless. Your arm's in a completely different position. It's like stuff like that that nobody really thinks or talks much about, that for a live show ends up being a huge deal. And then in the studio, the stuff like understanding headphones, understanding to always keep playing through until they tell you to stop.
Right.
All sorts of stuff like that. I've had so many takes that were like continuations of sections I was technically supposed to stop at after the chorus, kept playing through to the end of the song, and that's what makes the record.
Yeah, so, I think it's like that. I apologize.
No. That was pretty much it.
I think what you're talking about exists in every single business, and it's the little things that most people are actually unwilling to do that are very unglamorous, extremely unsexy, boring, fucking pain in the ass.
Yep.
But you do that stuff and other people aren't, and that's what gives you the credits to go forward.
Yeah, that's sort of minutia. Well, it's weird. It's like, I can't remember this quote. I think it's actually from a clothing designer. I think that's who it's from, but it's something along the lines of, the details are not the details, they are everything.
Yeah, they are, man.
And that's sort of the mindset that I take on, and it really doesn't matter what it is. And I think that it's hard for people to get across. You know, I teach now at Los Angeles College of Music. Awesome. My friend Molly Miller, who plays with Jason Mraz and has like a doctorate from USC. She's an amazing guitar player and a great, great person. She hired me onto the faculty. I don't work there full time, but I do teach there. And, you know, whenever I go in for a class, like I went in to do a last minute sort of sub thing last week, and we were going over some songs. Like, we were going over how to use delays. And we were learning, still haven't found what I'm looking for. Sure. You too. And I went and did, before I taught the class, I went and found every forum that talks about the delays, what exactly they were, what delays he was using, what the milliseconds were. I wrote all of it down. I had all the, and the kids had known about this for 2 weeks longer than I had. And they hadn't gone and done that stuff. I was like, guys, that's the kind of work that if you put into an audition,
yeah,
or you put into something like that, nobody else is going to do that for the most part. It's an automatic leg up, and you just got to put in the time. I mean, you really got to put in the time. I actually really love U2, especially their early records, but like, yeah, I didn't, I like, know that. All that sort of minutia about what his settings of delays were. But you go figure it out, because that's the whole point of what the class was like,
sure,
was recreating record sounds, which, you know, I learned a lot of that from Corey Churko, which I think we'll probably
get to later. He's probably a wizard in the studio, man.
Dude, I really think if I were going to pick one guy in the world to recreate record guitar sounds and then play them, I would pick Corey Churko.
There you go. Shout out to Corey.
One person in the world, for real, that Corey is, in my opinion, absolutely unrivaled in that respect, because of his knowledge as an engineer and working with Mutt Lang on top of being a guitar player, and Mike Shipley and other guys.
look at that guy's story, man. He was freaking busking in the Canadian winter for like 3 years. Nobody,
out of the music business. He wasn't even doing computer animation or technology.
Graphic design, I think he was
graphic
doing
design.
It. Yeah. Yeah. It's just, I mean, this is why I love talking to people, because everybody's story is just like, you know, it's never, oh, I just did this and this. And, you know, there's so much going on behind the scenes that
absolutely
real.
I mean, even my story, I know it seems like it's like, and I know in the grand scheme of things, everything kind of did happen quickly as we're kind of talking about with all these things consecutively, but there's, you know, we're not talking about the times in between those where you're like, my life is ruined. I have no money. I have no gigs. I'm in Alabama. I'm not around anybody I know. This culture is completely, you know, there's all those extended moments that, I mean, realistically, there's more of that than there are the sort of like high moments on top of the mountain.
Did you have anybody to hang out with in Alabama at all? Like, did you meet anybody, like maybe when you were doing the laundry or something like that?
Dude, not really, man. I mean, I was driving. So that bass player, Kevin Scott, that now plays with Wayne Krantz, I would drive. I don't even know. Remember how long it was? Three and a half hours from Alabama to Atlanta.
God.
To play two songs at his jam at the Five Points Five spot. He had a weekly jam he hosted. I would literally drive from wherever I was living, Jacksonville, Alabama, or whatever, to Atlanta to play for two songs.
Wow.
And hang out with musicians for the night. And Kevin was cool enough to let me stay with him a couple times. And,
oh, that's nice.
But he was hanging out with the heaviest Atlanta guys, like the top guys in Atlanta.
You get to meet Chris Blackwell?
I don't think I got to meet Blackwell. I don't think I did. It was kind of the guys that – it was a lot of his buddies that were like jazz cats and fusion guys. That was more
– Barry Richmond?
Man, dude, the names are all escaping me.
Oh, it's all good, man.
Because they were all like, I would see them for a night, and then I wouldn't ever see them.
Sure. Yeah, of course.
But yeah, there was some real like, that was the first time I was around an actual full-on scene of like musical killers.
So what did that feel like for you? Because you're still a kid, man. You're 17 at that point.
I mean, I was sneaking into all these places too.
And I don't know how, because you look like you're still 17 now, man. So I don't know how the hell.
I don't know how I did it, because I wasn't wearing a hat. I had a shorter haircut, and I kind of looked like a giant, like, top of a penis. Like, flash helmet situation. It was not a pretty look. But I don't know. I don't know how I got in, to be honest. I don't know if it was because I had a guitar. They just didn't card me or what.
Probably, yeah.
That was probably it. But – yeah, dude, I just got in and was just like in the corner watching and trying to take it in. And I'd see these people come up and do these weird sort of avant-garde, almost like David Lynchian, like a girl would come up and play like murder ballads. A girl with all these tattoos would come up and play like 1930s murder ballads. I didn't know what I had no experience with that. So it was a very eye-opening experience.
Joshua, nobody has experience with that. Don't worry.
Yeah, just her.
There's only one person has experienced that. You saw her that night, man.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, it was an eye-opening experience for sure, because there was none of that in San Diego.
All right, I'm going to talk about – so, you know, so the net result is I really have a lot of respect for you and, you know, really for having the courage and the confidence to go do that. And it worked in this case, and it worked big time. So good for you. And,
thanks.
And you know, for people that say, well, you know, everything worked for this guy, so what? You know, I mean, unfortunately, you know, I would rather have everything work for me than not, you know, who the hell wouldn't, but you propelled it, man. You know, you propelled it. It's not like you sat there and people knocked on your door. No, you went out and knocked on there. You did the guitar con. You went to Guitar Center the second time and did it. You know, you sent the CD out, you made the phone call, you shot the email. So, you know, that's why you do these things. Cause you hope something good comes out of them. And it did.
Yeah. And it was, look, man, music, as it still is, it was everything, man. It was like, it was so immediately everything for me that, I mean, all through high school, it was like primarily, and it didn't feel like work, but I was working, I was playing guitar 8-9 hours a day. And like,
sure. That's, there work. Was, that's, Earning stripes, man.
I loved it. And I think that's what propelled, I think more than anything, that's what propelled the sort of work ethic with it, which was, I just want to be doing more than this at a higher level. I want to be playing with guys that can kick my ass musically. That's what I wanted to do. I always appreciated the quote of like, you never want to be the best guy in the room. You never want to be the best guy in the room. And I always was like, I want to be around guys that can crush me musically.
Sure, because you learn.
Because you learn. Like, I had no sort of shame about just being inquisitive to people, because I think that's what kept me sort of level-headed through this whole thing, was like, I was so self-critical, because there was no like comparing myself to local guys or other guys in my high school. It was like, when I was jamming to Hendrix records and Allman Brothers records, I wanted to sound as good as them, not as good as Teddy down the street. That's not,
not as good as somebody jamming to them.
Yes. Yeah. So there was no sort of like middle ground. It was like, I wanted to sound like I belonged playing on the record with those guys.
And so where did that come from? Why do you think you're
everything that I do, I've always been like that. Everything. I think the first thing that I remember doing that with was cars. My parents bought me this giant, probably the size of the real books that my computer is currently sitting on. This giant guitar book. And I went through and memorized most of the book, like what the horsepower and the engine type. And I was like 5, maybe 6. So like, I was like obsessed with cars. I just like memorized most of this book. And then I got into skateboarding after that. And skateboarding was my entire life. Like when I was like 9 or 10, I was skateboarding with like high school seniors.
That's a big culture in San Diego thing,
right? It's basically like, if you don't do that, you're a weirdo.
Yeah, right.
I mean, okay. For real. Like, that's, especially in like the suburbs of North County, San Diego, like that's, you just do that.
That's what
and you, I was yeah. never, I couldn't swim well. So surfing wasn't really an option.
Sure.
So skateboarding was my whole life. And just like with music, I was always doing it with people significantly older than me. I mean, when you're 10 years old, somebody that's 16 might as well be your grandpa. Lead.
Yeah, right. That's a huge.
You know? So, you know, that was always the case. I was always with people that were better and older than me. So, and I don't really know any other way. I still don't. It's like, if you're going to do something, I just dive balls deep all the way in. I just don't know any other way. There's times it's detrimental in my life, certainly, especially probably outside of music stuff. But I just get obsessed, man. I get obsessed and I want to improve. And I'm willing to put in the time because the results they're worth it for me.
Good, man. It's funny, man. I have been like that most of my life. And I find like I spent the first 50 something years of my life being that. Now I'm spending all my time trying to unwind that so I could be more gentle with myself and just back, just relax, you know, because because that's really what you need to do as well. But you don't, when you're in it, it's hard to see that, you know.
Sure, but you're still working your ass off. The amount of podcasts I see that you repeat, I'm like, dude, this guy is like, dude, he is truly a next level podcast master. I mean, the amount of podcasts you do and the amount of research that you must do for each person, I found that extremely inspiring. And you know, you sent your bio over and I was like, man, this guy just whoops life's ass. I love it. I love that.
I've been whipped enough by life, so I have to whip back, you know.
But I just feel like I learned that from my parents, of like appreciating people, and it doesn't really matter what they're doing. I like hard work and craft.
Yeah,
it doesn't matter what it's in. I could watch somebody make a fucking pie. I could watch it doesn't matter what it is. If they're an expert at it, I'm interested.
I think people who are inherently curious are all like that, because as you realize, if you're curious, that man, there's a lot to learn out there, you know. I have this expression, smart people realize how little they know and stupid people think they know everything. It's really quite funny, you know, because you meet people like they're really smart. Like, God, that guy's so fucking dumb. How could he, you know, it's like.
And there's a great Bukowski quote about that, right? There's that really fantastic Bukowski quote about the confidence of people who don't know anything. I can't remember the quote. I don't want to mess it up. I'm too big of a fan to screw it up. But there's I remember a great quote about that, about, you know, the people that have the most knowledge in something realize how little they know, and they're the ones that are sort of self-defeating in the sense that they are always questioning themselves as well. And people that don't have a lot of knowledge, they don't question anything because they don't know how little they know.
They don't know how little they know. Well, it's funny you mentioned that. Yesterday, when I go on the treadmill, I often watch video. I watch the stuff that my wife won't let me put on when we're in bed, which is mostly music stuff, right? So there's a really good movie about a guy called, you know who Gil Scott Heron is by any chance?
Of course. Yeah. Okay. He's fantastic.
Right. Well, he's dead now, but there's a movie called Black Wax about him, and it has his band. I was like, God, these guys are great musicians. So I spent like 2 hours yesterday trying to track these guys down, and I emailed the director of the movie, and he's like, well, I made that in 82, but try this guy, Ron Holloway, who's a pretty well-known sax player.
I emailed Ron.
And then I emailed two other guys. Right. Sometimes. He plays Umbrellas, plays Warren Haynes, and Government Mule. And then I emailed like a few guys I know that thought, and all this shit's going on, and I probably won't get any of these guys. But I'm like, and it was funny. That's the stuff I love doing.
But that's so cool that now you have an outlet where you can actually – be like, I have a reason to get in touch with these guys.
Yeah. Oh, it's fucking amazing. Are you kidding?
That's really cool. I first heard about him they were playing him before a John Scofield live show in San Diego when I was in high school. And I heard it. And I was like, who is this? And it was Gil Scott Heron. And then I realized he'd been sampled on a lot of my favorite hip hop records.
Very much.
And went and, you know, became a big fan of his. But yeah, I just heard him at a live show and like wrote it down. I went and asked the person that was like on some, you know, somebody's iPod or something at this venue. This is incredible. Yeah, that he's amazing. But that's so cool. I hope you get a hold of some.
Oh, I hope I do too. But that's what I was thinking about when you were talking about details. I'm like, I know exactly, because even in this show, there's just a million things that you got to do that I'm happy to do. But like, I know that makes, or I feel that maybe that gives this show a little more of an opportunity to be a little better, you know, to have better guests on, to have more interesting guests on, to make more connections. Yesterday, I'm sitting down, this guy calls me from France, and he's was one of the member of the UK subs, you know, hardcore punk.
Yeah, I know them.
Yeah, and then we were talking, so he's coming on, and now, so I'm getting into that niche. So it's on, I'm like, I love it, man. Because just said, I have an excuse to talk to all these guys now. Like, how cool is that?
Dude, sometimes all you need is an excuse.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So anyway, I want to talk about, this is about you, but I related to what you were saying very much. All right, let's talk about some of these artists that you've worked with. Talk about how you got the gig and if you have any cool or interesting stories about working with them. And you mentioned Koshi. Let's start with that. Koshi and Abba.
Okay, well, so let's go back to that King of the Blues night, the final of that. So that was an insane night. So that was like the biggest show I'd ever played. It was at the House of Blues on Sunset Boulevard, which no longer exists. So it's probably, I don't know, 2,500 seat place.
That's really cool.
Something like that. And the band was Pete Anderson. You know, Pete Anderson.
I had Pete on the show, of course. Yeah, man. He's great.
And so he was the house band. He created the backing tracks for Guitar Center for that whole thing.
That's funny.
And so he brought this house band with horns and this whole thing.
Did you get to meet him?
I did. But, you know, a regret of mine is that I was not a giant country music fan at the time.
Right.
Now I am. And I'm a huge Dwight Yoakam and Pete Anderson fan. I wish I had that knowledge then because I could have brought it up. But at the time, I barely even knew who Dwight Yoakam was. Country music was not on my radar yet. But he was great. The band was great. Basically, I played, I didn't think internally that like, oh, I won this thing. But I thought based on audience response, because I saw everybody that played that and I was like, man, I think I might have won. I did not.
There was a whole
this guy, I can't even remember his name. He played two slides at once, which is some crazy. That's some next level.
That's not necessarily musically like what you're gonna do. I mean, it's like that's more like a
like a parlor trick.
Yeah, like a stunt than a. Yes. I mean, are you gonna go out in front of on a stage and play? Oh man, everybody knows him. He plays two slides at once. No, that's not going to happen.
It was a weird thing, but in the end, this all worked out. But at the time, there was a whole conflict about who won, and Bonamassa ended up playing before us. He was supposed to play after they announced the winner. There was like arguments backstage. Apparently, the judging, like people were yelling at each other over the judging. It was a crazy situation. I ended up getting like second place, but I lost. And I lost. There was a lot of money at stake, and there was
gear.
$25,000 and then like $12,000 of gear. So there's a lot.
Yeah, that's
at that age, that would have been crazy. So I I lost and I tried to keep a, you know, brave face on, and I was bummed, but you know, I walked off stage and Robert Knight comes up to me in this dark alley. This is like a scene out of Almost Famous, which is hilarious. It's like a dark back alley behind the stage. And he walks up to me, hands me his card, and said, "This isn't over for you. Call me tomorrow." And walks into the darkness of the
hallway. That's really cool.
And I was like, what? And I knew who Rock was.
What just happened?
They had made a documentary about Robert's life called Rock Prophecies that won a bunch of awards.
I gotta watch it.
So right. I had seen that movie, so I knew who Robert was. And so I called him the next day, and I started driving up to LA like literally 2 to 3 times a week there and back same day. So I'd drive 3 hours up from San Diego, 3 hours back, like 2-3 times a week to come meet with Robert in LA. Just to, you know, he'd be at the Sunset Marquee and he'd introduce me to the guys in Green Day and blah, blah, blah. And they were, you know, because he knows all these cats. So I was sort of, for the first time ever, really in the music industry, where I was up meeting folks like, you know, label executives and all these types of people.
At this point, he had you had hired him to be your manager.
Yeah, I'd say about a month in, he was like, "Hey, do you officially want to, you know, do a management thing?" And, you know, nobody's asking to manage a guitar player at that age that's not necessarily an artist and is like 17 or eight. I think I was maybe had just turned 18. So like 6 months, 8 months into working with Robert, I get an email from him. And he goes, "Hey, there's this band Bees." He's like, "I shot them for some documentary they made because they knew about me. They just hit me up and they said the singer, Koshi Inaba, is going on tour. He needs a guitar player and they know that I know a lot of guitar players." So he sent them like 5 names of young-ish guitar players, because that's who Robert primarily knew. And they wrote back and they just said, "Who's Josh? Who's Josh for?" Whatever. That's all they wrote. So he gave them a little bit of a breakdown. And then they wrote back, "How old is he?" I think I just turned 18. "He's 18. "No, okay, thank you." And Robert wrote them back, said, "Please let him audition. If you don't like him, fine. It's not going to hurt anybody's feelings, but let him audition, please."
Yeah, don't write him off because he's 18.
Yes, which, look, I get why they would. I mean, this is, you know, it's a big tour. And even though it's not with Bees, they usually play like, what, I don't know, 4 or 5 dates at the Tokyo Dome, 75,000 people. But just the Koshi solo tour, his solo tour, we did like 3 or 4 dates sold out at Budokan. So like that's how big this guy is. So it's a big tour, and picking the wrong person who's never been on the road, A, it's not a very Japanese thing to do.
Yes. It's, you know, they're very steeped in culture, tradition.
Yes. And sort of like not taking these massive risks of like, I could have wrecked the whole tour. I mean, realistically. So whatever. So they, I think trying to mess with me, they sent me a bunch of music and I had like 2 days to work on it. And I barely slept, dude. I slept just enough for retention of information, and that was about it. So I went hard on this music. So I go up to Simi Valley, where we mentioned before, where Shane Gallis lives. The audition was at Shane's house.
You didn't know Shane at that time?
No. I had never heard of Shane, actually.
That's so funny. Like, he's a monster drummer. That's such a funny, that's got to be intimidating. Like, that's the guy you're doing your audition with.
I didn't know anything about, other than seeing the Bees videos, which he does do a big rock thing, but he doesn't do all that Shane is capable of doing necessarily.
Well, it's a pop gig.
Yeah, I mean, it's a rock gig, and they want him to be a real rock drummer. There's a lot of fills and stuff, but when you hear Shane play on his own stuff, like, dude is capable of anything.
Yeah, he's a very talented musician in general.
You hear him play guitar.
His guitar playing is great, yeah.
And he, like, doesn't think it is. I'm like, the fact that you haven't played barely at all in, like, 15 years and he just picks up and, like, shreds, it's ridiculous. Yeah,
it is ridiculous.
So it was him and then the bass player for the tour, Corey McCormick.
Okay.
And Corey had been hired a couple months before. Corey now plays with Neil Young.
Oh, wow.
So I'm in the room with some super heavy guys, and then it was Kayo, the tour manager, who probably kept me alive and functioning while I was on the road eventually. So I'm auditioning with them, and they're filming it, and they're going to send it to Japan. So I'm literally in Shane's amazing home-built studio. They filmed this whole thing, and they hadn't really rehearsed because they're not rehearsing yet. So they knew the music, but not inside and out. Because
was Corey new to the band as well?
He was new, but he auditioned with different music.
Okay.
So he learned these songs for my audition, and he learned them, but there was a couple points where they're like, what's this break here? And I was like, and I was able to be like, well, that's actually a bar of two. And then we come in on the and of one, and Bob, and they were like looking at each other like, okay, this kid knows, he knows these songs.
Yeah. That's really impressive. That is like so cool, because that shows you did one thing. You did your work.
Yes. And to be able to tell that, I was like, man, the fact that they hadn't rehearsed these songs might've gotten me the gig.
That had to make you feel pretty good when you had to do that. Yeah.
It did, but I also left. I remember calling my parents after that and being like, I didn't play that well. I didn't, you know, cause it is weird being on camera too. You're performing like you're really on stage for nobody.
Yeah.
So
let me ask you one second. Yeah. Why, it just dawned on me, why do they fill up these bands with Americans? Cause like white guys are like more pop, like an attraction there, or?
Well, I don't think it's that. I think the biggest thing is that they know that sort of rock music was born here, and they know they know that there's a specific feel that North American, I should put the North in there because Shane's one of our glorious
Canadians. Yeah.
He's a prairie boy.
Shane and Corey, all these guys.
Yes. They're all, dude, a lot of them. But yeah, I think it's partially that. It's there's a certain rock vibe that you get from American music, that's American players, that's just different. It's there's a certain, I don't want to say authenticity, because that sounds
I get it. I mean? No, it's inherent in it's more inherent probably in a musician that's grown up here than a musician that's grown up in Japan.
Exactly. And look,
it may not be like that in 25 years over there, but for now it's probably, this yes. might be the turning point.
And dude, look, Koshi Inaba as a lead singer, dude is like Steven Tyler level good.
Yeah.
I mean, he is a true rock star in every sense of the word. And obviously he's a Japanese guy. So it's really, you know, I think that a lot of the bands that Koshi was listening to were North American bands. I think that's, okay. I think that's part of it.
It's interesting. I had a guy on last week, Nick Van Dels. He's a guitarist and singer for a band in Germany called Zodiac. Great blues rock band. And I said, how come, you never sang before Zodiac? And he goes, I had to sing for Zodiac because I didn't want another German guy who had an, I didn't want something like Klaus Meine from the Scorpions. He goes, you know, he's fine, but I didn't want someone singing English with the German accent. And Nick himself grew up in Canada most of his life, and the Netherlands and Germany. So he doesn't have, at least when he speaks English, he doesn't have a German accent. So he was forced to, yeah. So it was kind of like the same thing, because he wanted it, you know, they're playing 70s. He didn't want to sound like a German guy singing. He wanted to sound like an American guy singing.
And yeah, it would sound like the Scorpions immediately.
It would immediately, right. Exactly. Yeah. So it's funny, man. So, okay. So that makes total sense why they were having guys from the States do this gig.
Yeah. And I didn't think I got it, dude. I honestly, I remember being at a Jamba Juice, getting whatever berry BS I got. Just sitting there.
So you can see you're a good young kid, man. You know, another guy would be like, man, I went and got fucked up that night. I was so depressed. You're like a Jamba Juice, having an Acai bowl or something.
Yeah. I'm sitting at the bar at Jamba Juice all my life. No, I really left. And I mean, that just shows like I didn't leave being like this cocky, like, man, I just fucking nailed it, dude. Yeah. Like that wasn't my vibe. I was happy to have done it, but I did not leave being like, man, I crushed that. I mean, I thought I did relatively well, but you know, you get picky about stuff. That's what musicians do. So 2 weeks later, when I got a call, I'm in San Diego, I get a call from Kayo, the tour manager, who actually lives in the state. She's like their sort of American, a window into the Americas.
Sure.
Where she lives here and communicates with the management group in Japan. She's the only one that lives here. She said, hey man, this is a 5 or 6 month, you know, if including rehearsals tour, starts this summer. You want to do it? I said, hell yeah, let's do it.
Cool. And, man. That's good.
And then a couple months later, I was in Japan. I was there for, I don't even remember, something like 5 months, almost half a year, if you count all the rehearsal period and all that stuff.
Get to come over and see you?
Oh yeah.
Must have been nice.
My brother, that was kind of the moment. It was like my parents knew that things were going well I was doing well, but financially nothing had happened.
Right.
Right. Nothing
until that gig.
This is nothing that like, oh, this is a real career until that gig. And my parents and my brother flew out to Japan, and they came and saw the dates that were turned into a DVD, which, because Koshi is so big over there, was number one in Japan for a while, this live at Budokan. They came and saw all the Budokan shows. That's so nice. It was like 25,000 Japanese people and like three white ass people. I could see them from the back. It was so funny. Like, I could see them out there. My brother, you know, is wearing like a, you know, an orange shirt. And I'm like, hey, that's, you know, but it was crazy. It was like, that was the moment that they were like, this is a real job.
That's nice,
he's
man.
Making a real living, and this is what he's going to be doing.
That's cool.
You know,
it sounds like they were pretty supportive of you anyway. Like, that was not an issue for them. They sound absolutely like the kind of people, like, you know, you're happy and you're, you know, you're having fun. But as a parent, you're always comforted knowing, okay.
I should caveat it. They were extremely, extremely supportive. And luckily, because I'd had these sort of building blocks of success, they were even more supportive. But it wasn't like they were unaware of the downfalls, the pitfalls of the music industry, and the fact that you do need to make a living. And the fact that nobody they'd ever known is in the music industry. So
it
was kind of the understanding of like, hey, go and do this. If you're like 23, 24, and you're not making a living, you got to go to college. So it was kind of like, it was support, full-on support, but it was also like, look, dude, you're an adult and you have to make... You know, because as supportive as they are, they're also very highly logical people that understand that, like, you can't just live in the world and be, like, borderline homeless all the time. That was not something they wanted for me, and that's not something I wanted for myself.
Yeah, of course.
So they were super supportive, but also with the understanding that, like, let's see how this goes. You know, obviously college is always an option, but I think at that Koshi gig was when they realized that's not going to happen. This is full in. It's now a job.
Good for you, man. That's awesome.
It's a career. Yeah.
Very cool, man.
Yeah.
You know what? In hindsight, it's funny because you were saying I didn't really kill it at the audition. As an outsider, I could look at that and say, well, how could you kill it? Nobody would ever expect you to kill it at an audition. You just got the CDs 2 days ago. You know, you had 2 days. You know, I mean, realistically, it's not possible to kill it.
Yeah,
it is impossible for you to do a great job.
Yeah, and I think at best, I think there's a certain sort of ceiling for what you can do, but that's absolutely just not how I saw it. I just was like, you
of course not, because you're not looking at you from an outsider. Because as you were saying it, I'm like, and you know what, I don't, until honestly, like maybe in the last honestly 6 months, I wouldn't look at myself like that, but I'm like specifically working on stuff like that now in my own self-development of, you know, being more realistic and like, you know, looking at yourself from another set of eyes to give yourself a better, you know, less slack, less stress.
Sometimes other people are the best sort of window into your, like the way that you're perceived publicly and the way things went. Sometimes your own internal dialogue can just divert you away from that.
Yeah, a lot of times.
And dude, I should say this. I actually just learned this recently. After that audition, Shane sent Koshi an email saying, hire this kid.
Oh man, awesome.
And Shane is so like I owe him everything for that. He never told me that story until like recently.
Really?
That was almost 10 years ago.
That's a good interview. You ought to go back and listen to his interview. It was pretty intense.
I should go back and listen. I listened to a little bit of Churko's last night because I was like, oh, you know what? I didn't listen to Churko's interview. So I was listening to that.
Of course it's good. Shane's was intense, great. Though. Shane's was
I need
intense.
To, I need to listen back to Shane's and check that out.
We got deep on that.
I'm sure. But I owe him everything. Him and Koshi for the fact that Robert for getting me that audition, Shane for hitting up Koshi, and Koshi for trusting Shane to pick me. Because I mean, that's I'm on awesome. The road with Shane, who's played with Yngwie and Michael Schenker and Bees obviously, and Slash now. Yogi's in the band, Yogi Lonich. Yogi's played with Buck Cherry and the Wallflowers and Chris Cornell and Corey McCormick. Didn't have a ton of big credits then, but he's played with Neil Young for the last 7-8 years now. Wow. So I'm in the band with these like super, super heavy dudes and this Japanese keyboard player, Akira, who's ridiculous. and is in a big kind of fusion jazz band over there. But yeah, I really was in the lion's den with some of the heaviest guys that have extensive tour experience.
That's what you said you wanted.
Exactly. Yeah. That was exactly it. And I got to learn about being on the road, how to not freaking die or get lost or be late or lose your gig or the etiquette behind stuff, all that.
Are you good with, like, you don't party a lot, or do you party, or have you partied? No, not at all. What, how come? That's interesting.
Doesn't interest me at all. The alcohol thing, I mean, I had occasional, like, you'd go to parties in high school and play beer pong or whatever.
Yeah.
And occasionally get a little bit. I always hated it, but I think it was, there was no drinking in my house. My mom has really never had a drink of alcohol. My dad has like a beer every 3 weeks. Like,
yeah, yeah. You know? Sure.
So there was really no drinking. And like my brother's full on straight edge. He's never had a touch of anything ever.
Interesting.
So that runs in the family. And I had really, really, really chronic stomach problems. And that's actually one of the reasons guitar worked well for me, because I could stay inside and do it. I didn't really talk about it to a lot of people, but I had chronic stomach pain 24 hours a day, 7 days a week.
What was it?
Well, it turned out later that I had a couple different things that were wrong. I had H. pylori, which a lot of people have, but it's not active in most people.
Isn't that a bacteria?
Yeah. So I had H. pylori for a decade, and I had this thing called SIBO, small intestinal bacterial overgrowth, that was constantly causing pain. And I was dealing with diet stuff and trying to figure out diet. And it took me literally a decade.
Do you take probiotics to work with that?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. All of it. Dude, I tried everything. I mean, it was literally a trial and error for almost 10 years. I was going to doctors. Nobody knew what was up. So that was one of the reasons I would stay inside and play guitar so much.
How are you now?
Almost, like, there was a bunch of scarring in my intestinal tract.
Wow.
So like, once I got all this figured out and they run a scope down there, they're like, this is going to take years to recover.
That's okay. You got that years.
Yeah, that was about 4 years ago. And it's gotten only better from there. But yeah, that was a big part of me practicing so much, was I was in so much pain that going outside was kind of unbearable. Not unbearable.
So this allowed you to be wet your dry, you're ambitious, you know, allow you to accomplish stuff, you know,
without needing to be out.
Yeah, that's great.
You know, it was rough on the road often because the food thing, especially overseas, was tough. And you know, when you have chronic pain, you don't want to talk about it, because if you let that door open, you could be talking about it all the time.
Oh yeah.
And then you become a bitching baby, and that's one thing that my family always taught me not to be. So, it was a lot of years of dealing with those chronic stomach. And I think that comes back to a lot of the sort of discipline of things, because I had to be disciplined with food and shit, where it was like, okay, you can't have bread anymore. You can't have meat. You can't have alcohol, would wreck me. So I think that part of the partying had to do with living a lifestyle appropriate for my
Your physical condition. Health,
yeah.
Yeah, man, you know what? If you got to omit something at a young age, as a musician, alcohol is about one of the smartest, you know, it seems like you're sacrificing, you know, oh, everybody else is having it. I'd like to get a buzz once in a while. And it's all true, like, but, you know.
It never felt like that. I think another scary thing was when I was doing the blues club thing in San Diego, because that was my only real outlet in high school. A lot of the guys I was playing with had some serious problems with drinking.
Really?
And
okay.
Seeing that was like, it's not growing up around parents that drink. I was like, this is dark.
Yeah.
This is dark shit, and I don't want anything to do with it.
It's interesting when kids, my kids, we had, like, when we were raising our kids, like, we'd have a pina colada, like, on Thanksgiving or something, right? I mean, sure. That was, and it was really funny. Both our kids, their first jobs were working, our sons were working in supermarkets, and they both said the same thing when they started work, you know, after school. They said, I can't believe how much beer people buy. I got the guy coming every day and buys a 12-pack, because they had never even seen us have a drink. So it was really, and it was, I was like, you know, I was laughing when they said, I didn't, because you don't realize it. That's just, we didn't have time to, you know, we're raising kids, man, and working.
Yeah, and working at a supermarket, you get to see if there's a guy that comes in four or five times a week, you're the only guy other than him that knows he's been there that many times.
Yes. But it was funny though, because we were like the standard of it's not like we didn't like, we just had no time. I've always been self-employed, you know, and has always worked or taken care of, and we just had no time. We're raising kids. We got no family here. It's like, when are we going to drink? You know, we got little kids here.
Yeah.
You know, what the hell? I would love to have a drink.
Yeah, I get it. I feel like I feel very lucky to have grown up in a house without drinking.
Yeah, yeah, it's probably helped you. As a musician, I would say it's probably helped you out.
When talking to people that are musicians, how many did have that in their house? Yeah. I'm like, Jesus, I got very, very lucky.
No, you did. I would say it's better to be on that side. Okay, Koshy, that was a cool story. Talk about any cool stories playing with Koshy.
Oh, yeah. First night, this is one of my favorite stories. The first night, so the way that his show worked, we had this incredible, almost like front cover of the stage. It was like maybe a third of an egg.
Okay.
It goes over the front, like if the audience is where you are. So it's this, yeah. We're behind it. And it's kind of this like, you know, third of an orb almost. And it you can't see through it. It's like a wall.
Right.
So the first night we come out and we're playing one of the smaller venues, but it's like still like 15, 16,000 or something the first night.
Yeah.
You know, and during sound check, the orb's not down. So, you know, I see how big the room is. I walk out on stage like 10 minutes before. You can't see the audience. And I couldn't hear the audience. I remember taking my inner monitor out of my ear. Being like, is this a joke? There's nobody here.
It's completely silent. You literally could hear nothing.
Nothing. And I knew that this is a sold out show. I'm like, what the hell is going on? Is this a prank? I literally had the thought, dude.
But they're pranking you on your first
gig. Elaborate Ashton Kutcher is going to fucking bungee jump in from the top of this thing and be like, dude, you actually suck at guitar. This was all a joke. Like, I had that go through my head because I really was like, this is so weird. The opening thing, you know, there's an opening video that is played on the front of the orb. Still no sound at all from the audience. Then all of a sudden, the first note, the piano hits a low bass note. Shit goes translucent. There's 16,000 people there. And then all of a sudden, they go absolutely insane. Yeah! And they start screaming. And I was like, what? So then we played the show. It went extremely well, but it was very nerve-wracking. Because keep in mind, the only show I'd ever played was a King of the Blue show for like 1,500 people.
And now
I'd
never been on stage 10 times that.
And I'm like rocking. There's a giant stage. Like, I didn't really know how to perform in that context. But weirdly enough, it just happened completely naturally. Like the first time it was like, oh, this is what you do. And it didn't feel like I was putting on, like now I'm performing. It was just like, I naturally move when I play anyway. But in blues, that's not really a thing that you do. But it was like very natural immediately. But after the show, I went up to Caio, the tour manager, and was like, why was there no volume? No audience? She goes, they don't want to miss the first note of the show.
That's just a Japanese audience.
Yes. So they were quiet. They knew the show was coming up and they didn't want to miss the first note. And I was like,
wild.
Oh my God. That's the wildest shit. That's so cool.
Yeah.
And that was it. And that was like that the rest of the tour. It was like the whole time.
Isn't that interesting how that's a, what a,
talk
do they
have, about
do they do lighters and stuff like that? Or not lighters anymore or whatever.
No, because it was pre sort of giant light on your phone. Because this was 2010. Yeah. Yeah. So it was like, you know, you still had Blackberries and stuff.
That's so fun. And Blackberries. Talk about Beth Hart. How'd you get that gig and any cool stories from there?
So I got off the road with Koshy, did the whole tour, was out there for all that time. And at the end of the tour, all those guys, Shane and Corey and everybody, was like, dude, you got to move to LA. You can't live in San Diego after this. So right after the tour, I figured out, because it was weird. I was literally playing Budokan or whatever. And then I was taking out the trash at living at my parents' house in San Diego. At the suburbs of San Diego.
Oh, my God. Like,
dude, oh how the
fuck. That is so funny, man.
It was such a...
I'm in Budokan, and then I'm taking out the trash. You must have been like, get out there when you put the trash lid back on, look around and said, this is not going to fucking happen. This is not going to
work. Dude, it was one of those things where like, I love my family, but I was like, after being on my own, like, I can't live with
Oh, you can't live after. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So I moved to LA within like 5 months. So 2011, cool. Like January 2011, I moved to LA. And I got the audition for Beth Hart not too long after that, maybe like 4 or 5 months after being up here. And it was another thing through Robert Knight. Hmm. And, you know, Beth had just done this record with Bonamassa, and it was big in the States, but it was huge in Europe. It was a really big record.
I think Rob McNally played on there, so I know that record we're talking about. He was one of the session guys in Nashville.
Maybe he did. Did he play on that? I thought it was only Joe, but I could be wrong.
Yeah.
I love Rob McNally's playing. He's fantastic. He was great on that first Casey Musgraves record, and he's great on some of those Buddy Guy records too.
Yep.
But the record's a very guitar-heavy record, so it's pretty much featuring Joe and Beth. Like, they're the forefront of that record. And, you know, I knew Joe through Robert Knight and through the King of the Blues, and Joe had always been super cool to me. Like, because I wasn't weirdly competitive with Joe. Like,
You did your thing, he did his thing.
Yeah, and I really respected Joe, but it wasn't like I was like, let's get on stage, I want to, like, because I know a lot of young guitar players, especially in that sort of blues rock world, want to get up and like go toe to toe. I have no interest. I don't care about any of that stuff. Yeah. It's sort of like cutting room. Like, that doesn't mean anything to me.
That's so really healthy that you don't feel like that.
Yeah, I don't think it's a good thing. And Joe was really cool. So basically, I think that the situation was Joe has his own touring shit figured out, right? That's why he's been able to absolutely crush it, make a bunch of money. He's got his whole touring situation set up. So he was kind of like, I think he was like, you know, I'm not going to do the touring with Beth and the whole thing because it's like, I've got my own thing. So Robert recommended me to Beth. And from what I understand, Joe gave his blessing because he knew who I was. I actually have never asked Joe that. But from what I understand, Joe was like, oh, I know Josh, so he'd be a great fit or whatever. Mm-hmm. So I went and did the record tour for the record. And we did like first time in Europe. I was there for half a year over the course of 3 months and 3 months. And it was amazing. We were playing these really hip clubs, like this jazz club, New Morning in Paris. But then the next day we'd be playing in the Netherlands, where she's a legitimate pop star. And we'd be playing a festival for 50,000 people right before Lenny Kravitz headlined.
Oh, wow.
It was this weird thing where, like, because she does blues and soul, but also does rock and also has like pop hits in Scandinavia and the Netherlands, we would be playing all like little jazz clubs to huge castles to opening or to playing the second headliner at a rock festival before Lenny Kravitz or Chris Cornell or something. So it was a really crazy experience, and it was cool because I got to understand what festivals were like, jazz clubs, playing in these weird old like castle venues in Germany and France and shit. So I got a big dose of what it's like to be touring through Beth.
Very cool.
But I got the audition for Shania in between those two runs with Beth. So I got the call that I got the Shania gig while I was on the road.
You got that through Robert again?
No, I actually got that. Check this out. It was through Shane.
My man.
In a sort of roundabout way, Shane Gallis, because when I first moved to LA, I went to go have a jam at Corey's place or at Shane's place in Simi Valley.
It's after B's. Okay, you guys are all
after B's. So I'm up in LA, and since I'm in the same city, he's like, hey, you moved up, let's jam. So it was like me, and I think I was going out there to jam with like, maybe it was Travis Carlton, Larry Carlton's son.
Yeah. On bass? Yeah.
Yeah, who's fantastic. And he was like, on the way out there, he's like, why don't you stop at my buddy Corey's house? He has my Marshall head, and you can use that when you come out here. So I met Corey for five minutes.
Oh, okay.
5 minutes, dude. I went into his studio. He showed me around. He wasn't touring with Shania Twain, so Shane had really introduced him as like, Corey plays with Kelly Clarkson. So Shania wasn't active. Yeah, Kelly was active, and Shania wasn't. So the Shania thing didn't even really register with me at all. Picked up the head, had a nice conversation with Corey that maybe lasted 5-10 minutes. That's it. And that was it. I don't even know if I got Corey's number. A year and a half later is when I got hit up from management, I didn't even realize it had come through Corey because they didn't mention it came through him. I just got hit up by management. When I arrived at the audition, I was like, oh shit, that's Corey. He recommended me. So I didn't even know.
So he, what was he doing? You were coming aboard as rhythm or what was, or was he utility? What was going on?
Well, it's interesting because when Corey was in the band in the 90s, when Mutt Lang was still there and was running it, Corey was hired as a fiddle player, right?
Yes, I remember.
Even though guitar was his main instrument. So,
and then something happened with the guitar player and he got that slot, I think, right?
Yes, but he was never a full-time guitar player with her. He was always playing a lot but was doing fiddle too. So I think it was a bit up in the air. I think Shania wanted like a lead guitar player. Not that Corey couldn't play it, but I don't think she had seen Corey in that light because he primarily
played
a utility guy. And when he played guitar, it was mostly rhythm stuff. But let me be perfectly clear. Corey is capable of playing anything on the planet.
Yeah, he's
so a great need me there, but I think Shania was like, we need a lead guitar player. So
and much to his credit for saying, hey, let me recommend a guy. And, you know, that took courage, to be honest with you, instead of saying, wait. Yeah, right. It took no ego.
No ego. And that's one of the things that's I love.
Class. Yeah, he's a class.
Class act. Yeah. Total class act. And, yeah, so I went and did the audition, and there was a couple of them. Like, I drove out to Vegas, I think, 2 or 3 times during that break from Beth Hart. And then I got the call while I'm in a bus or a van with Beth Hart and got the gig with Shania. And I was still on the road with Beth, so I literally was learning the Shania catalog while on the road with Beth, came back, and then a month later started the rehearsals for the Vegas residency.
And you've been with her now, what, like 3 years now?
Shania?
How long have you been with her now?
2012. So
7 years.
7.5 years now.
Wow.
Yeah.
Awesome.
And I did the Vegas residency, the 2 years. Then I did the Rock This Country. Then we did a bunch of like a promo tour in Europe.
Wow, dude, that's great.
And then we did the Now tour last year, which was a world tour that lasted like 9 months of last year.
And you play lead on that?
Well, I mean, it's now, I think I played a little bit more early on because, you know, of the situation, but now it's, I'd say I play a lot of the leads, but Corey plays them too, and there's a lot of leads that go back and forth.
Okay, cool.
Where it's like he plays one, I play one. But yeah, Corey and I split the parts up pretty evenly. That we try to, you know, give each other cool parts on this song and that song, and yeah, there's certain parts that one of us can play with more. You know, I think certain things just lend themselves because we're very different players.
Yeah, you pick and choose what makes the most sense.
Yeah.
Yeah, that makes perfect sense. I mean, you're serving the music that way.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely.
Has there been any downside, and I don't know any way to put this, to getting so many good gigs early on in your career? And what's downside is not the word I'm looking for. Has there been any
sort of detrimental sides to it,
or false sense of like that bad times don't come, for example, or false, you know, of because as everybody knows, you get a gig, you could be making more money than anybody in the world, it ends, and then you're making zero.
Exactly. I don't know if I think there's a ton of potential for it. But I don't think I let it happen because the logical side of my brain and the sort of person internally who's hard on myself about working hard and getting better wouldn't let it happen.
Good.
Because I was always aware of, look, no matter how hard I work and how much I care about this, there is luck involved. There is fortunate circumstances that, look, the serendipity of a lot of these stories, I mean, every story I've told you has some amount of serendipity. It's not just because I was practicing my ass off. And I think seeing really killing players as I was coming up that never got their break really, really sort of smacks you in the face and lets you realize, like, there is a certain amount of serendipity involved. It's the most I've ever used the word serendipity.
you got a lifetime in now.
Well, it's weird. Like the luck, fortune, and serendipity are all kind of like they're all different sides of the same coin. But there is a lot of that, and I never. No,
but forgot. I think serendipity implies some sort of like maybe God stuff or stuff in the air or whatever you believe, or spirituality. You know, I think a lot of it is involved in that with serendipity. That's how I use the word.
I guess I've never thought of it as I guess I mean just the circumstances of life fall in a certain way that, you know, I also think because of all the chronic stomach problems, I didn't let the sort of lifestyle get a hold of me. And because of the way I grew up with my family, like the whole like rock star stuff, I was like, I don't give a shit about that. And right. I think sort of the era of the effed up rock star on drugs is over. That's not a thing anymore, dude.
No, it's definitely not.
You know it better than anybody talking to, like, especially as a session and hired gun musician.
You'll be out of work in a minute. Day.
Show up hungover and 10 minutes late to the bus.
No, you're done.
You're done. It's not a thing. So, you know, back in the day, you see these videos of these session guys and touring guys. First of all, they were one and the same back in the day a lot of the times. Like Gad and those guys, like, they would tour and be session guys, but they're on coke and so is the artist though. So, but that era is dead, man. And I don't mind that. Like I don't yearn for that at all. And I feel lucky that, you know, I want to be a professional. I want to be a pro. I don't want to be a liability.
Yeah.
You know,
somebody said it really well. Someone I interviewed said, I take my career seriously, but I don't take myself seriously.
Man, that's a great quote.
Yeah, I thought it was really good.
That's a great quote.
I thought it was really good because I believe in that. I take my work seriously. I don't really – that's it, you know.
I think if you start to take yourself too seriously, you lose all ability to have any objective –
Well, not only that, let me just tell you, man, being 55, life's going to come around. People are going to get sick. You're going to get sick, maybe. Shit, you're going to have a bad day. It's going to rain at some point. You can't be an asshole when that stuff happens because if you're, you know, there's no reason, you know, if you're like even keeled, then you're not falling so far. It's just like, oh, okay, totally. I was prepared for this, you know? Yeah, man. Well, I'm glad that you.
I could not agree more with that. I never try to take myself too seriously. And the whole social media thing, it's like I take it seriously in the sense that I want to keep stuff on there that
sure.
is interesting and I like. I think that's my key for filtering stuff. I only post stuff that I'm excited about. Yeah, but I also try to not take the whole thing too seriously because it is kind of funny to have this, like, you know, online persona.
Everybody's a guru, man. It's, like, really funny. Like, you get everybody people post like deep quotes all day long, like that implies
they quote themselves.
They got their shit together, but you don't. And I'm like, that always cracks me up.
When people post quotes of their own words, like in the post is literally a photo of a quote that they've said.
That's quite funny.
Out,
yeah,
get
man,
out
that's,
of here. Get out.
It's
here.
Just hard to listen for me to listen to anybody that does that. Even it's like, oh, okay. I'm happy that you're so valuable in your eyes.
Exactly.
Nice. Yeah. Great.
Yeah.
The other thing you do, and you're like, I really respect your hustle. You do clinics, you do education, lessons. Are there any other side hustles going either in the music business or outside of music completely?
I mean, like you said, I do a lot of, you know, I teach some private lessons. I teach at Los Angeles College of Music. I've done a bunch of clinics internationally for Yamaha. Like, they've sent me all over, dude. They've sent me to Japan and Thailand and Ukraine and the Middle East.
How was that?
Going to the Middle East?
Any of those. What was any cool stories from there?
Culture shock. I mean, there was a lot of, because I go alone. I mean, there are Yamaha people locally that when I'm going to the event are with me, but I'd fly out alone. I'm not with a band or anything. So, you know, I'm experiencing these things either completely alone or maybe with one or two people who work for the local Yamaha.
Wow. So you're like landing in Egypt or wherever, like.
Dude, I landed in Qatar the hour after Trump was elected.
Oh my God.
In the airport, I had just voted in the States, got on a plane, had a layover in Qatar for like 4 hours. There's people yelling at the TV screen. I'm just like, oh my God, what the hell is going on? So it was, there's been some trippy situations. Ukraine was a crazy, all of them. I mean, Japan wasn't crazy because I'd been there before, but I mean, dude, I had never been out of the country before touring. So I had no international experience. So all of this was new. I'd never been to Thailand. That was awesome. I loved Thailand.
Yeah,
that was fun. So I went back there multiple times with Yamaha.
That's cool.
And then I also do clinics locally. Like I did some clinics at USC, which was cool. You know, being somebody that didn't go to music school and self-taught to be doing a clinic at USC. And
that's got to be pretty cool.
And then teaching at LACM, where you've got Molly is the head of the guitar department, who, like I said, plays with Jason Mraz. And, you know, Adam Levy is there. And
Adam played
with Mark Jones and Tracy Chapman and plays with everybody. He's one of the heaviest dudes. And then the head of the drum department and one of the starting dudes of the school is Ralph Humphrey, who played in Frank Zappa and the Mothers of Invention on all that early stuff.
That's cool.
Funny story there. My brother kind of like co-runs or and helps design for a shoe company, like nice made in Leon, Mexico by hand shoes and boots. And the guy who started the company, who's his best friend, Aram, he is engaged to Ralph's daughter.
That's pretty funny.
Ralph Humphrey is going to be his daughter-in-law. So before I worked at the school, he came to one of my shows and she's like, yeah, this is my dad. And they're like, yeah, he played with Frank Zappa. I was like, how did you guys not tell me this ahead of time?
Deal. That's so funny.
Yeah. So I teach at that school. You know, another, I guess you can consider the top side hustle. I do a weekly show called Boba Jam.
Yeah. I've seen you promote that on social media.
Yeah. So it's a weekly show.
Where
at
is
my
that?
Friend's Boba/Tea Shop. Arlene, that runs this amazing, her parents, I believe, are from Taiwan, and she gets all these amazing teas, and it's like the most legit boba shop. It's really great. She has this massive back patio that I believe used to be an auto repair shop, so there's a ton of space. So I asked her, I've known her for years, and I asked her like 4 or 5 months ago, like, why don't you have music? And she's like, well, I don't know if it's financially viable, and also people want to do it at night, and we're kind of in a neighborhood. And I was like, what about this? What if you don't pay us anything, and we do it during the day? She said, cool. So I started doing it, and it's just purely for the love of it. It's 100% improvised show, and every week I get a different band.
Oh, that's really cool. So,
dude, we've had – I mean, I've had John Button from The Who.
I had John.
I've had Larry Goldings from James Taylor and John Mayer's band. I've had Adam Levy, who, you know, came out and played. The amount of people that have come out and played it, when you have guys that play with Neil Young and Ziggy Marley and Sarah Bareilles, Nora
Jones. You got Adam Zimmern there?
He's come out and hung out a bunch, but he hasn't played it yet. So
he's a really, really nice human being, man. He's a
could
very
not be
funny nicer. Guy. He's a very funny guy, too.
He's hilarious. And actually, I wrote a column for Premier Guitar, another thing that I do, on Bob Marley's rhythm guitar playing.
Oh, cool.
And he and I, because he plays with Ziggy, he and I have had a long conversation about that, about how people overlook how difficult reggae rhythm guitar is.
Yeah, because you're playing the same thing. Ching, ching.
Dude, you got it. And
the
he
whole
was
song. Really,
yes. And I really related because I love rhythm guitar. The column I write for Premier Guitar, one of the columns I wrote was on Malcolm Young from AC/DC, and then the next column was Bob Marley. So it's like,
that's very cool, man.
Yeah. Steve Cropper, I think, is gonna be one of the next ones, and I want to do one on Lil George as well, and Little Feet,
yeah.
And the incorporation of second line rhythms.
That's awesome, man. Are you able to make any money doing that, like through donations, or is it all just fun stuff?
No, it's fun. It's like purely, I don't want to make, because I don't get to pay the musicians. They do it for the love of it, too. It's
okay.
I'm very fortunate to work with an artist like Shania and be able to make a full-on living doing this. So this is purely a thing where it's like, and it's clear that these musicians want that. When you get guys that play with The Who and James Taylor to come out and do this gig purely for the love of it, you realize how fun it is for people to show up with no music and improvise the entire show.
That is cool.
It's, and every week it's different, man. Sometimes it ends up more kind of like avant-garde, sometimes it ends up sounding like a loop of like a hip-hop song where it's like we're all looping parts together. Sometimes it's very Allman Brothers sounding. Sometimes it's really, you know, Tom Waits, J.J. Cale. Like, it really depends on the players every week because I get different types of players. I mean, I've had, like I said, the amount of people that have been willing to come out and do it and the high-level players that are willing to come out. Every week, it's like I get to play with three of the best musicians in the world. For real.
Where does this take place for listeners?
In the Arts District of North Hollywood at a place called T-Pop, T-E-A-P-O-P. So I do that every single week. I'm going to be taking a break when I go out with Shania, but I'm starting to back up in January.
So good at T-Pop.
It's such a blast, dude. And look, every week we get it's like packed in this patio every week. And the people in the audience, it's like we got, there's, you know, John Spiker, who's the bass player in Tenacious D. And there's, you know, Terry Frank, who's like the house keyboard player. He's kind of the most consistent musician that does with me. He plays or played with Tedeschi Trucks Band. Like, he's keyboard player after Kofi unfortunately passed away.
Sure.
So it's like you get to play with these super heavy dudes, and it's awesome. It's the best. And ladies,
you started that.
Just come out and played.
Who?
Molly Miller.
From
ladies too. I started that because I was on the road with Shania for 9 months last year, and it was amazing. But you're playing the same set every night. And look, I learned from improvising along the records, dude. So like that was something I was like, I need that improvisational aspect of my life. And I've done so much improvising. I really am not nervous even improvising with these monsters because I feel I've done so much of it that it's not about, like, I know when not to play. I know when to lay out. I know I learned all that stuff from over the years doing a lot of shows and blues clubs where I don't know any of the music. Now, granted, it's blues, it's three chords, but there's still hits. There's this and that.
Yeah, sure.
But stay the hell out of the way. So
good that you're doing this. I apologize.
No, sorry.
I'll say it's good that you're doing it too because you're probably becoming networked with a load of people, which is always great. You know, to know more musicians is wonderful.
Dude, the amount of people, I realize how much I say dude now. It's a problem I'm realizing.
It's a music thing. You know what? It's really, I was telling my wife when I first started this show, I'm like, man, it's so cool to talk to musicians because, you know, you could always say like dude or hey man or.
Yeah, it's like the ultimate like. There's no formality to it.
No, none, but it's like so relaxed, you know, and I don't have to, you know, second guess myself. Am I too casual? Because I like being casual, you know.
For sure.
The business world, I love it. So,
But I've met so many musicians through this. It's absurd.
Yeah.
I can't even explain that. Almost every week, there's either a musician or multiple musicians that I either know and have not played with or have never even met. I've just cold called people.
Yeah.
I'll just write them. I'll try to get an introduction from a friend. Honestly, that's something I related to with your show about booking the show where I was like, man, Craig and I actually have something in common with that because I'll reach out just or have people recommend people like Satriani did for you, like you were saying the show when we were talking, where I'll have somebody play and they'll immediately be like, you got to get this guy to come play it.
Well, if you want an introduction, any of the guys I've had on my show to come to Boba Jam, just let me know.
I appreciate that.
It takes nothing to say. That's a fun thing. Why would I not? Yeah, I'd be happy to do that.
It's cool. I love doing it. And so, yeah, I cold call, cold message, whatever the hell you want to call it, a ton of people. But almost every week, there's somebody there that I've never played with.
That's cool, man. That's really good.
Yeah. Very and a lot cool, of times man. What I'll do is I'll leave it up. Like I'll hire one guy, whether it's, you know, whoever it might be in the band that week. And I'll ask them, who do you want to play with that you have not been able to play with? Where you've talked about it and it just hasn't happened or you love their playing. So
that's really cool.
Dude, I have people all the time being like, hey, this bass player, we've talked about gigging for 3 years. It's never worked out. I'll just call them. Hey, here's the opportunity. Let's make it happen.
Right. Well, plus you get other input too, which makes your life easier.
Exactly. Yes.
Not that that's why you're doing it, but you start realizing, man, this is a lot of time. If someone can give me a hookup, it's like, you know,
it's logistically, you know, booking people every week it's not easy, but because there's no music to learn and because it's during the day, almost everybody's available and down to do it. If they're in town, they're pretty much cool with it. So man, I've met so many people. I've gotten tons of work from it, like sessions that have come from it.
I was going to say, I'm pretty, yeah, I knew that. I had it in the back of my mind. I knew that you
were going
to do it. That's good, man. That's why I said it's good that you're doing that, because in this business, you get work from knowing people, period. Period.
Absolutely.
You know,
absolutely.
The more people you know, and the better job you do, you get more and more work. So, I mean, that's been my observation. Let's talk about gear, Joshua, for a little bit. What's your go-to guitar that you like to play? Not that you have to play for a particular session or particular artist.
Well, so I've been with Yamaha now for a decade. So Yamaha. So what happened was, I won't name the other company, but I reached out to another company when I got the Koshi gig, and they could not have been more dismissive of me. And I didn't have a big head about myself, but I was like, man, I'm going on this big ass tour. Arena tour with a huge artist. I would think that there'd be more interest. So I ended up being at a Paquito Moss in LA with Robert Knight when he was managing me. And we ran into Ken, who is a guy who's worked at Yamaha for 35, 40. He's been there for a long time.
Wow.
And Ken said, why don't you come by and try our guitars for the tour? And I knew their acoustic instruments because I'd seen a lot of pros play their high-level acoustics. But to be honest, I hadn't seen a lot of the electrics out there. So I decided to go by and play the acoustics. And I was kind of convinced while I was there, why don't you try our electrics? And they brought out all these guitars that I was like, what are these? They're like made in Japan in their custom shop in Hamamatsu. And they were incredible. They had the whole SG series, you know, that series that Santana used to play in like the 70s. They had these new models. They had a gold top one with P90s. And I was like, what? But basically, I told them like, hey, man, I had two guitars and I had this big arena tour. I didn't have enough instruments, to be honest. I had an acoustic and two electrics. I had a Les Paul and a Strat, and that was pretty much it. And maybe I had an SG from that King of the Blues competition too. So basically, I was like, well, we talked to Yamaha and they were like, we'll hook you up for the whole tour, but we have to do an exclusive deal. I think that was it. They said, we want to do an exclusive deal for you. And I said, well, I'll need a decent amount of guitars if we're going to make that happen.
Yeah, you got an exclusive, man. You got to load up my guitar stand, brother.
They gave me like 5 or 7 guitars on that tour.
Oh, so they like, made it worth your while. Good.
High level, like all custom shit, all but from man, Japan.
But that's what's fair. That seems to me to be fair. If somebody wants you to only play their guitars, great. Then hook me up so that I could only play your guitars. You know, don't give me a Les Paul and say, you can't play anything else. It's not feasible. Yeah.
And ultimately, and this comes into play later on, it's up to the artist what you play, dude.
Yeah.
That's another, if they have a specific request, you have to do that. So Yamaha hooked it up, and I've been with them forever. They are incredible to me. They've been so amazing. And Pat Campolitano is their custom shop builder, who also happens, he got the job at like 26.
Oh, wow.
He's the head custom shop guy building bases for Nathan East and Billy Sheehan and, you know, the dudes from the Smashing Pumpkins. And he is just the absolute man and got hired like a couple years out of Berkeley. And so I've got half my guitars from Yamaha are made in Hamamatsu, Japan in their custom shop. And then the other half are completely custom, where I go to lunch with Pat and we design a guitar at lunch.
Oh, that's cool. That's a good lunch.
Yes. So for instance, my main guitar right now is a guitar that he just built 100% custom for me this year. It's we'll call it a T style or a Tele style guitar.
Do you have it nearby by any chance?
Yeah. Yeah. Let me grab it. Check this out.
That'd be cool. I like seeing them.
Now, I hope it comes off this way. So it's
oh wow,
like a 50s GM pink.
Yeah, that's a really cool pink. It's like what's that? What do other companies call that color?
You know what? I don't know. It's like a soft pastel.
Yeah, it's like pastel. It's really cool looking, but it's very retro looking.
I sent him here. I'll show you the photo. I sent him a photo. I think this photo is a photo. I don't know where the exact here. Let me just bring it up for you because it's really cool. I sent him this and said, "Can you please match this color?" And they did, and that's what this guitar is. So
it's like going to Home Depot and say, "I need to paint this."
Well, dude, on all the times that, that they've done that, I've gone to the paint shop with them and mixed it with them.
Oh, that's really.
I don't go and match the color with them. Oh, here it is.
Oh, that car. That is so funny.
It, I don't know if you can really see it.
When you hold it up close, you can. Yeah, it's a pink convertible, some sort of old school retro convertible.
Yes.
Hold up your guitar again, please. Okay, so let me just, for people listening to the show, it's a pink sort of telly looking guitar, like a little cool looking than a telly, white pickguard, relic'd, very cool, but not over relic'd. Ashtray.
There's some cracking in the on the paint where he put it in a freezer several times to get the paint to crack. It's just cool, man. It's
cool. It's a really cool looking guitar. Is that ebony or rosewood?
This is actually baked maple.
Okay, it's really dark. It looks pretty cool, man.
Yeah, yeah. It's and there's no sort of finish on it, which I like. So basically, everything about this, so down to like the size of the frets, they're not jumbo. They're kind of just under that. Mark Rudders, who I've known since I was 16, because my dad sold him stuff. He owned a CNC machine company, and my dad would go golf with him and talk about guitars. And Mark was like, "I think I might retire in a few years and start making guitars." Mark Rudders. And the dude's a straight up genius, like legitimately, like he has a lot of CNC machine patents that are like internationally recognized.
Oh man.
And he now is retired and just makes guitar parts and guitars. And he makes the best 1950s repro Fender parts in the world.
Really looking like a good ashtray looking bridge.
It's the other way around. Notice the pickup is swapped.
Yeah, that's right.
I know it's weird because the way that
the
pickup, instead of being this way, is this way. So it's a little bit beefier here, or a little bit beefier up top and not so bellowy on the bottom. It's his. All of this is Rudders. These are all Rudders.
Those and are the tone knobs and the volume. That's really nice looking.
Isn't that cool? Like, so all of that is like through his CNC machines. We have a Lawler 51 Tele pickup in the bridge here. Mm-hmm. This is a Rickenbacker toaster pickup made by Lawler.
What does that sound like?
God, I don't even know how to describe it. I originally asked him to put a gold foil pickup in the neck.
Yeah, right. I love those.
It didn't match the bridge. I love the sound, but I was like, the sound is too different. It didn't work.
Okay.
So Pat literally was like, I got this. Let's try it. So he just picked it up out of a little tray and popped it in. It has a little bit of a hollowness to it. I'd say it's like a slightly more hollow P90.
Okay.
I would say. And then, you know,
wow, that neck is dark. It looks great, man.
It's really fantastic. So this is kind of my number one in my layback from here. That's very not cool. My number one guitar, because that guitar was just finished about 3 months ago.
And that's a custom Yamaha.
Absolutely custom.
Beautiful guitar. It's
technically a Pacifica, which is kind of their somewhat umbrella term for the single coil style guitars. But you know, the shape is different than a Tele, and he went and made a bunch of changes and to the classic Tele vibe.
Very retro, man. It looks, with the color and the shape of the guitar, it looks really retro. I like that.
Yes, and almost all of my Yamahas, obviously the custom ones were painted custom colors, but all of the ones from Japan I've had repainted to be like 50s cars.
Oh, that's nice, man.
So I've got I've got one baritone guitar that's painted like a 67 Corvette or a 67 Mustang with the racing stripe. And I've got a Cadillac green kind of semi-hollow body, think like 335 as a reference. I've got another one that's kind of like a Gretsch Country Gentleman that used to be kind of orange with like the shark, you know, shit on there. But I was like, nah, I'm not into that. It's too shiny. So we painted it. I found this old book of GM paint codes online.
Oh yeah, I've seen that.
Matched them. So I found this old like scan. And so we went and matched that. So that's kind of like, but I have.
Man, how fun is that though to go sit and do that?
Dude, it's a dream. It literally is like pinch yourself dreams. Yeah. It's insane. And the fact that Pat's one of my really good buddies, like even outside of Yamaha. So it's just cool as hell, man. So that's when nice. I play with Shania and stuff and all that, like I play all Yamaha. Now I have other guitars when I do sessions and stuff. You know, I have a bunch of other old weird vintage guitars and stuff, but the Yamaha is like, when I play with Shania, I have like 16 guitars because I have to. because of all the different tunings and the specificity of the tones that Mutt dialed in on the records. So like, I've got like 16 guitars in the road with her and they're all Yamaha.
That's a massive amount of guitars, man.
It's a lot, a lot.
But at least, but it's all at the same place though. You're not like right now, you're just going back to Vegas. It's not like,
They're going to send Cartage out here and they're going to pick literally 16 guitar cases up in a couple weeks.
Well, okay, so all your guitars basically went, or the primaries are Yamahas.
Yeah, yeah.
I think that's cool that you said to them, hey man, if you're going to give me an exclusive, if you want an exclusive, make it so that I could genuinely be an exclusive.
And they have, man, have they followed through. I have a ton of Yamaha guitars, and dude, they're fantastic. I mean, the quality of workmanship on their stuff is very Japanese.
Yeah.
You know, hardworking, meticulous. It's awesome.
I had another guy a long time ago. You know Fish Herring? Mike Fish?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I know. Well,
he's a Yamaha artist, yes, too, I think, isn't he? Yeah.
Yep. Yeah.
Ever sell a guitar you wish you can get back? You wish you could get? Yeah.
No. No. And the reason for that is my dad had a Les Paul in the 70s that he's got like two photos of. It was bone white with the gold hardware. And I remember him telling me, God, I wish I didn't sell that guitar.
And it always stuck with you?
And it always stuck with me. And I'd never have sold anything that felt sentimental. I've sold guitars, but nothing that was ever – I don't really sell vintage guitars, and I don't sell any guitar that had sentimental value. Yeah.
Desert Island Discs, top three. No particular order, just for now.
I made a list last night. Yeah,
everybody does.
I have way more, dude.
Just three, man.
This list is so big. It's so big. Here, I'm just gonna read you the list. Is that insane to just read you this list?
Yeah, you gotta pick top three.
It's more than three. I gotta pick three. Oh man, yeah,
gotta pick top three.
Oh, jeez. Okay, let's go. Stevie Wonder, Inner Visions.
That is a very popular one.
First CD I ever bought, Stevie Wonder, Inner Visions.
Interesting.
Jeff Beck, Blow by Blow.
Great record.
Shit. Either Led Zeppelin, Physical Graffiti, or Megadeth, Rust in Peace.
That's a very, very reasonable, very well-rounded selection there, man.
Well, that's what I was trying to, that's when I was making the list, I was like, man, I like the genres. I feel like I need one from each. And then it ended up just turning into like, there's like 15.
Here. Oh, yeah. That's everybody does that, man. Same thing.
Yeah.
That's funny. Good selections, man.
Thank you.
All right. Tough question. What do you like most about yourself, Joshua?
I would say adaptability. I think that let me get the screen big again. I think adaptability has been a huge benefit for me, where no matter what situation, whether it's with young people, older people, people that play a style of music I don't really know. You know, when I got the Shania gig, I wasn't a country guitar player. I now am a country fanatic, but I didn't know jack shit about country.
Sure, of course not. Yeah.
So you learn on the job and you become adaptable in the moment. I would say, as harsh as I am on myself, I think that's something that I do appreciate about myself, knowing that I can be adaptable in those moments.
Very cool, man. Flip side, if there's one thing you could change about yourself, what would it be?
Probably a perfectionist mindset. I think that it's come in handy a lot, but I think that there's sort of the extra beating yourself up that doesn't need to be there, and you can still reach that same point of sort of meditative equilibrium.
Yeah, that's good. It's good that you realize that now, because it doesn't serve you, trust me.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. I think there's sort of a shortcut where I can still access the sort of good parts of that without accessing the bad.
Yeah, without blood out of a stone. Like 95% is really as good as 99%, but the extra that you got to kill yourself for, that extra 4%, nobody's going to know it but you.
Yes. Yeah.
Best childhood memory.
Oh, this is a good one. So I was a skateboarder. Like, that was kind of the thing that I did all the time before guitar music. And growing up in San Diego, North County, skateboarding was a huge deal. And also growing up in North County, there's a massive, massive Filipino population there. I believe it's the biggest Filipino population outside of the Philippines in the world.
Oh, really?
Okay. From what I understand. So the reason I bring that up is there's a really famous skateboarder named Willie Santos, Filipino guy that was, he was on Birdhouse with like Tony Hawk and all that stuff. He's a big time guy. He had this shop called Willie's Workshop, which was like the local skate shop that everybody went to. And this is so cool of my mom. She went to get me a ramp for my birthday and ended up seeing Willie Santos there and just straight up went up to him and said, can I pay you to come out to my son's birthday party?
That is so cool.
So I'm skateboarding with my homies, as we'll call them. I'm in like fourth grade, and all of a sudden this white van pulls up. We all look up, and this dude gets out of the car with his board and he's carrying a ramp on his shoulder. I'm like, who is this like adult man? And he gets closer and that's Willie Santos, dude. He came and skated with us for like an hour and a half on my ramp, on the rail. And this is like one of the most famous professional skaters in the world.
That is really cool.
So that is by far the moment that I'm just like, that's so cool. It was like, that was the greatest birthday ever.
That is a very cool thing your mom did, man. You got to get mom.
She's the best. That was such a cool. And I, from what I understand, I probably should ask her. I think she just walked up. Like, cause my mom just like, she goes after it. If she wants to do something, she's not pushy, but she's like, I see it, I'm going to do it. And she just walked up and made it happen.
Something or someone you miss from your childhood?
You know, I think it's probably what I said earlier about the lack of responsibility and life shit. as you know, like you're an adult, you got kids. You know, I don't have kids, but just being an adult is exhausting. I mean, it just is. You know? There's just so much shit to do all the time.
That's your quote. Being an adult is exhausting. That's awesome. Thank you.
You know, I miss going home from school and being like, yeah, here, let me spend 10 minutes on my homework so I can get it just enough to hand it in. And then the rest of the day, I can do whatever I want. And it's just not that way anymore.
It's funny, man, when my kids moved, I got one left at home. She's 19, but she's autopilot. You know, there's no maintenance with her. There's no parenting at this point. That is the thing I appreciated the most when they left, because I always felt that responsibility was so heavy. And like, I really enjoyed that, not having responsibility now. I really do, man.
Yeah, it's weird because I love responsibility in some senses. Like I love being a professional. Like I get a ton of enjoyment out of that, about that, like through that. I get a lot of enjoyment through organization. I get a lot of enjoyment through sort of things that as a kid you'd be like, psh, that's lame. And I love it now. But, and I even like being an adult in the sense that like, I like a lot of the aspects of it. I like cooking. I like this and that. But the amount of time it takes away from stuff that's truly...
truly fun or like not stressful.
Yeah, so just getting lost in stuff, yeah. Which is, you know, there's all those stories. You know, when you're playing 8-9 hours a day, it doesn't feel like it.
Right.
You play all day and you're like, it's midnight? What the hell? I've been watching The Office. And I guess now that's a reference everybody has because it's like now, what's a cooler reference now?
I don't know.
Stupid VH1 reality TV show and playing guitar all day. You know, you'd get lost and it would be 8 hours later, you wouldn't realize it. You hadn't eaten since like the morning. I miss that for sure.
Well, that's a good thing to miss.
Yeah.
You won't have it for a while. Sorry, Joshua.
It's all right. Overall, I do like being an adult more than being a kid, for sure. Yeah. A lot more.
Yeah, of course, because you have more control over your life. You don't have any control when you're a kid.
Yeah, and I didn't want to be a kid either. I always wanted to hang out with the adults. I didn't want to be hanging out with kids younger than me or my age, you know.
Well, that's probably why you've done so well in your environments, because, you know, being the young guy in the band and still doing really well, you must have an affinity and an aptitude to just get along with people older than you.
And I always had that. Yeah. I mean, at Christmas parties when I was like 13, I was talking with the adults all night. They're more interesting. I was like, I can learn stuff. What am I going to learn from like Timmy that just jumped off a roof because he's from there? You know what I mean? Like, that's the kind of like dumbass stuff that kids in San Diego were doing. I was just like, what am I going to learn from this guy who just broke his ankle jumping off a roof for fun?
It's a California thing. We never had that in New York City, man. No one's jumping off roofs for fun. Any hobbies or interests outside of music?
Vintage clothing and collecting stuff like that.
That's cool.
I have a lot of friends in that world. My brother works in that world. So he works in like sustainable, ethical clothing manufacturing.
Oh, very cool.
So like that shoe company that he works for, it's all like, you know, everything is like adults working and making legitimate wages. And he works for companies that hire women in India and pay them like American male, American wages.
That's cool. Really cool.
Stuff like that. So, I have a lot of friends, like my buddy Damien made this hat. I've got another buddy, Cody, who's one of the top like fedora cowboy hat makers in the world. Like he's
so funny because you wear all these hats and they're not hats that guys your age are usually wearing.
Totally.
They suit you, man. That's your vibe now, man. That's your thing. Like to see you without a hat would probably be weird, I would imagine.
Some people I think I have like the sort of monk haircut where it's just bald on top, but it's long everywhere else.
Yeah, but I'm sure you have a full head of hair.
No, I got some hair. I got hair under here.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Yeah. But that's, you know what's funny?
Like, oh, you got a ton of hair.
Yeah, that's a nice looking cap, man. You know what's funny? I don't wear a baseball cap ever for that reason. Cause I don't, like, I'm bald and I'm okay with being bald, but like a lot of guys wear baseball caps cause they're not, so I don't want to be one of those guys. Oh, he's got a baseball cap on cause he's bald. Cause I don't really give a shit.
I'm embracing.
What's that?
I'm embracing this.
Yeah, man. That's it. Then do your thing, man. Do whatever works, man. Favorite place you've traveled. Was it Thailand? You said that?
Japan. I think it was the first. It was also, I got to see, I mean, we only toured Japan. So I played every single major city, except maybe going to Okinawa, because I don't think it was financially viable to ship all the stuff on boats over to Okinawa. But I played every single city that has an arena in Japan. And I was there for a long time. I fell in love with the culture. I fell in love with the food. I fell in love with the people.
That's awesome.
It still to this day means, like, Japan means a lot to me.
Like, Shane said the same thing, I think.
Yeah, I think, you know, it's like one of those things, like, where if I'm watching the Olympics, the country I'm rooting for right after the United States is Japan.
Oh, that's nice, man.
Like, I feel like an actual, like, whenever I'm watching any event and the Japanese folks come on, like, I feel this weird camaraderie. I think it's, and Shane probably mentioned the same thing. It's not, it's also the mentality of work, hard work, and I mean, America's got that ethos as well, but there's a lot to it that I think is very
America doesn't, it has that ethos, it doesn't have it in practice. There's a lot of people that practice it, but man, there's a hell of a lot of lazy ass people here too.
Exactly. And I think my family functions under the guise of you work hard or you're a bum.
Yeah. Well, that's a culture in like places like Japan where, you know, it's, you're expected to perform. It's not like, man, he's doing great because he's performing. It's like, man, you're a pussy bitch if you don't do this, you know?
Exactly. And that's honestly, that's how it was in my family too.
Yeah.
Not that, more like in somewhat of a joking way, but if you bitch out on stuff, like you're going to get roasted.
Yeah.
Your ass is getting roasted. And that's the way I grew up. So, like, you know, there's no holds barred in my family. It's just kind of like, you're going to get roasted, deal with it. And, you know, that sort of thick skin, I think, helps a lot when you're in the music industry with the rejection and all that other stuff.
Especially in your profession.
Yeah, yeah.
Two more questions, man. And I really appreciate your time. It's very kind of you, man.
Of course, man.
what do you see coming? Like, what are your goals for the future? 3 to 5 years, let's say.
I want to start. I'm in the process of pitching some stuff for a big movie that I potentially might be writing music for. So that
awesome.
That is huge.
That is huge.
Obviously, I can't talk about the details and nothing's set in stone at all. But that is something that I'm absolutely looking forward to and hope to do more of. I want to continue to do. Sorry, go ahead.
Licensing, like tracks for movies and stuff.
But not only licensing, like writing composition for, because like what I'm doing for this stuff is composition.
That's great, man. Congratulations. I hope it works.
So do I. So for movies and TV, I want to start doing more of that. I want to continue to do more sessions. I mean, this year has been huge for me. You know, I've done more sessions this year than I've ever done before on cool stuff that has just been awesome. You know, like a couple months back, I got to do a session for a Little Feet tribute album
that's being made
by Inara George, you know, Lowell's daughter. And I got to do a track with Larry Goldens, he came out and played Boba Jam, but he's one of my favorite keyboard players ever. I've been a fan of his since I was in high school. His work with Schofield and John Mayer and James Taylor and all this stuff, and his own band with Peter Bernstein and Bill Stewart. Getting to go play slide on a Little Feet tribute track. Like,
that's great.
What? You know, I'm a huge Little Feet fan. Just all these sort of things, like stuff like that, moments like that. And then, you know, I got to do a bunch of stuff for American Idol this year where I got to play on all the finalist singles. And I got to play guitar, bass, mandolin, banjo, baritone. I don't even know. Basically everything. I got to play anything that I own. I got to play everything on the tracks. So that was cool as hell. So I want to continue to do more of that. And I want to start doing a little bit more production work as somebody that's working with the writing, arranging, and composition for my own stuff and then artists as well.
That's great. Dude, I predict that you'll be sitting here and we'll be doing another interview in like 3 or 4 years and you'll have a ton of new shit going on. Like building the JRG empire, man.
Man, I appreciate that. I really
look. No, you're a real hustler and you're like, obviously whatever you're doing, you know how to do it well. So, you know,
thanks,
honestly,
man.
Hats off to you. No, thank you. Not because now in 3 or 4 years, I won't be able to get to you. Only because I've gotten to you now. So everybody else will be like, no, man, I'm just doing
it. Dude, you got guys like Satriani and shit on here. And those heavy guys. I'm not going to be able to eclipse those guys in 3 or 4 years, but I appreciate the compliments.
No, I think you're going to do really well. Last question, man. Tell me about a specific experience that changed your life or altered the way you think about things.
I think it was with the Koshi gig. I remember distinctly, we went to dinner in the United States because they have a place out in LA. And I went with all the management and with the North American side of the band. I'm an extremely picky eater. I always have been. I've always been somebody that likes his stuff, and that's what I do, and whether it's with food or anything. And I made this distinct decision that night going, I remember driving to that dinner, going, I am going to break out of this. And it was that thing of like, once you're not in high school anymore and you realize like you can reinvent yourself whenever you want, you just have to make the decision to do it. And I remember going out being like, I'm going to try whatever the hell they put in front of me. If it makes me vomit, I don't give a shit. I'm going to eat it. So, but it was more than that. It was like the food was sort of like the physical embodiment, but it was this sort of like, I am going to have all of these new experiences and I'm just going to let them happen. And I'm going to be uncomfortable. I know it's going to be culture shock. I know all this stuff is going to be out of my comfort zone and I'm ready for it. So I remember going out that night and trying like all this shit and they knew I was picky and they were actually really honored that I would do that for them. And I think that was the seal on me not only getting the gig, but sort of being like, this was a good decision
for us
to hire this kid. I could sense them understanding that I was a professional, an adult. I was willing to learn and I was willing to adapt. And I think that moment was a big shift for me as far as like, I can adapt to anything and make it work. And I just remember that moment. It's weird just trying different food, but it applied all across Japan when I was there, and it's applied since.
It sounds like you were ready to mature, and then you made it happen, and you're just watching yourself and appreciating the process, which is really nice when you get to do that.
Yeah, it's almost like as you were outside of yourself watching, you're like, dude, you're doing it. You're doing it. It's a weird thing. It's that thing of like, you don't realize you have to just do it. To think about doing things, it sort of gives your brain this like false sense of accomplishment that you're not actually accomplishing anything just thinking about it. You have to do it.
Yeah.
You know,
usually I think there's not much thought involved when doing it. It's just
exactly. It's a thing. So I think I've learned more and more to just let's do this.
Awesome.
You know.
Well, dude, thank you very much for your time. I really appreciate it. I can see why everybody likes you. You're a good guy, easy to talk to, super smart, and you're going to be real successful. And you are already, but this is going to keep going. So you'll be back on here, talk some more tales in a few years.
Man, Craig, I appreciate you having me, man. This was fun as hell, and I hope to be back. I really do.
Of course you will, man.
There's so much more that I'm like, oh man, I can't even believe it's already been an hour and a half.
It's been 2 hours. 2 hours and 2 hours and 10 minutes. Yeah. That we've been recording. Oh. Yeah, man.
Whoa. I didn't even realize that. Well,
no, it's cool.
I look forward to this time, man.
Yeah, man. Let me tell people just a couple of things you got going on. First of all, check out the Hal Leonard book by Joshua Ray Gooch called Lead Guitar Licks. It's an improv, and he's working on it. You working on the second one now?
I'm not necessarily, I've been more doing the writing for Premier Guitar, but I think the option with Hal Leonard is open. They kind awesome. Of have left it open for, hey, when you want to do one.
Awesome.
Go ahead.
Lead Guitar Licks part two. And also follow Joshua on Instagram. It's real simple. It's Joshua Ray Gooch. His last name is G-O-O-C-H. You don't have to be related to musician Joe Gooch, are you?
No, but I do get asked that quite often. Did he play in 10 years after?
Yeah, he was in you know what, man? That had to be the toughest gig ever, man. Like, I'm going to take Alvin Lee's place for 5 or 6 years. They played here. I saw them, and he played great, but I was just like, meh. Yeah, you know, it's like Pink Floyd without David Gilmour. Yeah.
It's hard. It's a tough spot, but I'm not related to him, surprisingly.
Yeah. Not related. But follow Joshua on Instagram. Again, it's Joshua Ray Gooch. And if you want to check out the book, do you have a YouTube channel or anything like that? You don't, because I looked, I don't think you do. I've
been putting that together now. I do have some stuff, but it's not super updated. It was more an outlet early on before Instagram and all that stuff. I'd say Instagram, now that they've raised their limit to like 10-minute videos with IGTV, I post clips from Boba Jam live stuff. So basically everything goes there, but I'm actually in the process of uploading every single Boba Jam event onto YouTube right now.
Yeah, that would be good, man. Because there's
unbelievable stuff, and you get to see the process of improvisation, sort of finding the nugget of an idea live. Because I've had a lot of people reach out about like, dude, I don't live in LA, or I do live in LA. I've got a 9-to-5 though, and I can't make it. So I want to put all the Boba Jams on there. So I'm going to get some more content online. But as of now, at Joshua Ray Gooch on Instagram, that's where all of my updates go.
Great. So follow Joshua there. Also, if you are in North Hollywood, go to T-Pop. What day of the week is that?
Thursdays from 10 to noon. We're going to do two more. The 7th of November is going to be the last one of the year. And then we hop back on the first Thursday of next year, and we're going to be right back at it.
Awesome. T-Pop in North Hollywood, Thursdays, 10 to 12. And that's it, man. Thank you for everything. I really appreciate it. It was great talking to you, man.
And Craig, you're the best. This was fun as hell. This was awesome.
Thank you for saying that, man. I appreciate it. Hey, everybody. Listen, thank you for listening. If you enjoyed this, please share it on your social media channels. We appreciate your support. Thanks very much to Joshua Ray Gooch, and please support him. If you're in Vegas, check out the Shania show, North Hollywood again, T-Pop Thursdays, 10 to 12. And follow them up on Instagram. Oh, lessons. You do lessons. How do people get a hold of you?
I do. Yes. They can hit me up via Instagram direct message. That's probably right. The best way to do it. But I have an email on my website. But to be perfectly honest, the Instagram thing works so well. I check that all the time. So I teach private lessons over Skype and in person.
Awesome. And you also teach at Los Angeles College of Music?
Los Angeles College of Music. I'm a faculty member there. Awesome. And I'm going to be just doing some subbing this semester because I leave with Shania, but starting when I get back in late January, I'll be back on faculty there.
So he's a real, he's a real guitar player and a real teacher. So you can't go wrong. So hit him up on Instagram if you want any lessons. All righty. That's about it. Everybody, most important, remember that happiness is a choice. So choose wisely. Be nice, go play your guitar, and have fun. Till next time, peace and love, everybody. I'm out. Joshua, thanks for everything, bro.
Yeah, man.